Today's House Government Reform and Oversight Subcommittee continues its examination of recent reports of chemical exposures to troops during the Persian Gulf War in 1991. Over the next 3 hours and 45 minutes, you'll hear from a number of active duty military personnel.
Like to call this hearing of the Human Resources Committee, Subcommittee of the Government Reform Committee to order. Alarms have been sounding for almost 6 years. Only now are they being heard. From the start of Operation Desert Shield, when Iraq munitions and chemical weapons production facilities were bombed, and throughout the troop movements in Operation Desert Storm, coalition forces heard thousands of chemical weapons alarms. On numerous occasions, technicians trained to operate sophisticated detection equipment confirmed the presence of nerve and blister agents near U.S. troop positions in Iraq, Kuwait, and Saudi Arabia. Individual soldiers reported scud attacks followed by toxic mists and powdery fallout. They reported dead animals in the desert and a notable lack of insects or other carrion scavengers on the carcasses. After the fighting stopped, U.S. forces detonated Iraq chemical munitions stored in bunkers at Kamisiyah. To this day, many Gulf War veterans report the symptoms, memory loss, fatigue, muscle and joint pain, that can characterize a neurotoxic exposure. Routinely, all these reports have been dismissed, discounted, discredited or denied. Some were dismissed as false positive readings. Others were discounted as detections below life-threatening levels. Still others were discredited as attributable only to operator error. Based on these denials, commanders sounded the all clear for U.S. troops to proceed unprotected against an invisible enemy. Now we know the all clear came too soon. Last March, when we began these hearings, the Pentagon's position on chemical and biological weapons in the Persian Gulf War consisted of three no's: no credible detections, no exposures, and therefore no provable health consequences among Gulf War veterans. These denials were echoed by the Department of Veterans Affairs and reflected in their research and treatment priorities. Today, two of the three pillars of the denial have crumbled under the weight of reluctantly disclosed facts. There were credible, verified detections of chemical nerve and blister agents. The President's Advisory Committee on Persian Gulf Veterans Illness conducted detections of chemical nerve agents by Czech technicians in January 1991 were credible. The Department of Defense investigative teams is examining records for 20 other detections previously dismissed or discounted. Seven of these detections were acknowledged just last week. As a result, the number of U.S. Gulf War veterans presumed to have been exposed to some level of chemical warfare agents has climbed from 0 to 400 to 1,100 to 5,000 to 15,000 to more than 20,000. In the weeks and months ahead, that number of credible exposures may go much higher. This is our fifth hearing on Gulf War veterans' illnesses. Our purpose in all these hearings is to ensure that Gulf War veterans are properly diagnosed, effectively treated, and fairly compensated. Since 1991, one of their health concerns has been the role of low-level exposures to a variety of toxins, including chemical nerve agents, in causing permanent neurological damage and chronic, often debilitating symptoms. Our purpose today and tomorrow is to ask how evidence of chemical nerve agents detections, including the firsthand accounts of Gulf War veterans, is gathered, confirmed, and disseminated. Even now, more than 5 years after the war, chemical detection information is a critical piece of medical intelligence for a sick veteran trying to establish a service-connected disability claim or trying to provide his or her doctor with a complete toxic exposure history. Sadly, that information has not been forthcoming. Our witnesses today will describe how evidence of toxic chemical detection in the Gulf War has been lost, destroyed, misrepresented, perhaps even suppressed, in an effort to support the premature, now insupportable conclusion that coalition forces encountered no chemical warfare agents. For want of that information, vital research into the effects of low-level chemical exposures has been tragically delayed, and many Gulf War veterans have gotten sicker. Some have died. Only when all this information is available will veterans, their families, and their physicians be able to determine the true role of toxic chemicals in causing the variety of illnesses now called the Gulf War Syndrome. Only then can we sound the all clear. This committee welcomes our witnesses today, and we look forward to their testimony. And I'd like to recognize Mr. Sanders, the acting ranking member.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I really want to applaud you for your persistence in dealing with this issue and with the successes that you've been having. Answers to questions about troop exposure to chemical agents and their connection to Persian Gulf War Syndrome are long overdue. Over the last 5 years, approximately 50,000 men and women connected with the American military have complained of various ailments associated with the Persian Gulf War, and the time has long passed when they should be getting the answers to their problems. Mr. Chairman, clearly one of the major concerns that all of us had on this committee is that even though the Pentagon had information since 1991, this was not top secret information, this is information that was publicly disseminated, that coalition troops may have been exposed to chemical agents, I think the key question that all of us want to know is that how come it took the Pentagon 5 years to acknowledge that? And in fact, as you indicated, it was an acknowledgement kicking and screaming as a result of congressional action. And I think we have a right, the American people have a right, and most importantly, Persian Gulf War veterans have a right to know why this information was not forthcoming, and in fact, who is responsible for what might be termed at least an apparent cover-up. Why did we not get this information out? And what disturbs me very much is I don't think anyone here or any place in this country knows the exact cause of the problems. We wish we did. And scientists are working very hard to try to put together the various pieces. But if, in fact, what now appears to be the case, that at least some of our soldiers were exposed to chemical agents, then think about the waste of time that our researchers and our physicians had to undergo not to have this information. With that information, they could have come up with better diagnoses, better treatments, but they did not have that information, and I think there are people at the Pentagon who should be held accountable for that. What makes me especially sad is that it appears that we went through this syndrome once before in terms of Agent Orange. Some of us had hoped that the Pentagon had learned its lesson. These are complicated issues. Nobody knows all of the answers, but the very least that the American people and the veterans have the right to believe is that the Pentagon will be honest and forthcoming and bring forth all of the information so that our scientists and our physicians can get to work in trying to make life as best they can for the people who are suffering from the various ailments. Mr. Chairman, let me just conclude by thanking you and thanking mostly all of the witnesses and the people who have worked so hard on these hearings. And I am confident that this committee will go forward to get to the bottom of the story.
Thank you, Mr. Sanders. Ms. Morella?
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I also want to commend you on holding this hearing, not only this hearing, but I guess, as you said, this is number five, and we have another one coming up tomorrow. All of this is in search of the truth. And at some of the hearings, we have heard from some of the Gulf War veterans who have given us all of the symptoms and the concerns, the stress, the manifestations of what would be considered the Gulf War syndrome, a problem. And then we've had testimony saying that there was nothing to be concerned about, that in fact it didn't happen, that it was all imaginary. And now we know that there has been some detection of the toxic chemicals, but we don't know what happened to the detection. And so this is, again, a search for the truth. The public needs to know. Gulf War veterans have suffered for too long. And so I appreciate the fact that you have this hearing. Look forward to hearing from the witnesses, and thank you for coming.
Thank you, Ms. Marilla. Mr. Fattah?
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. This is our fifth hearing convened to explore issues related to the diseases suffered by some of the Persian Gulf War veterans and their families. There's compelling evidence that these illnesses are related to Gulf service, and in particular, to exposure to Iraqi chemical and biological weapons. Our purpose today is to determine what is known about the U.S. troop exposure to chemical and biological agents during the Persian Gulf War. Towards this end, I welcome the views of today's witnesses and thank them for their hard work in preparing for this hearing. Especially, I'd like to thank the active duty personnel, both for their presence before the subcommittee and for their service to the nation. The subcommittee is revisiting this matter because our understanding of what has happened to our soldiers in the Persian Gulf has changed. In the 10-month time frame encompassed by the subcommittee's hearings, the Pentagon's position has evolved from denial that any chemical exposures occurred to its current view that some 20,000 troops may have been exposed to chemical weapons. Serious questions have also arisen that troops may have been exposed to biological warfare agents. DOD's questionable handling of intelligence reports on chemical detections, coupled with its poor management of the issue in general, has jeopardized its credibility with the American public. Moreover, the Department of Defense early conclusions that no troops were exposed have clearly influenced medical and compensation policies at the Department of Veterans Affairs. We should be troubled that these policies were insufficient and inappropriate and may have resulted in the provision of unresponsive health care to Gulf veterans and their families. It's critical that we understand that there's been a sincere effort from the President to call for explicitly in his directives to the Pentagon to pursue this issue more aggressively. And he has named Rear Admiral Paul Buzak at the White House to coordinate Persian Gulf illnesses and the appropriate response. Also, since our last meeting, Secretary Perry has designated Bernard Rosker, Navy Assistant Secretary for Manpower and Reserve Affairs, to lead the Pentagon's inquiry into troop exposures and the medical consequences. Further, in response to public and congressional criticism, DOD has adopted six initiatives to improve its efforts. I'm hopeful that these very positive steps will help DOD intensify its focus and that we will see meaningful outcomes. Mr. Chairman, I encourage you to convene another hearing in the 105th Congress, perhaps jointly with the National Security Subcommittee, in which we can receive a report from the Department of Defense on the on its response and what has happened with its new approaches. I also urge you to include DOD's current findings, if any, regarding chemical and biological exposures so that today's hearing record accurately reflects the information the Pentagon now endorses. Mr. Chairman, I commend your diligence and interest in this critical issue, and I look forward to working closely with you as we continue this investigation in the 105th.
Thank you. Likewise, Mr. Fattah, thank you very much. We are joined, the Human Resource Committee is joined by our colleague, Steve Bouillet from the National Security Committee. He, my understanding, will be chairing the personnel side of that subcommittee and also serves on the Veterans Affairs Committee. And without objection from any of the other committee members, we welcome you as a participating member today in our hearing. You have been in the past, and I would also just point out that is Persian Gulf veteran as well. Mr. Bouillet. Hey,
thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just have a couple of comments I'd like to make at this point. Having dealt with this issue now for 4 years, I'm hopeful that the new Secretary of Defense will clean house with some of the individuals who have been stonewalling and myself, Joe Kennedy, Lane Evans, and this committee likewise, not only on the operational side, but also on the health aspects of this Gulf War illness issue. It's easy for us to pound the table. We all do that, but doggone it, this one is, it is so challenging, having dealt with this one for so many years. We have to almost take the issue and divide it between the operational aspects and the health care. I really appreciate this subcommittee getting involved. The National Security Committee, in my conversations with the chairman, will be very ambitious on this issue. And just because the National Security Committee in the next Congress begins to look at both on the health delivery system side of this for the military and the operational side, and I know the Veterans Committee will also move out on the claims aspect of this one, I encourage you to continue your focus as you've done in the 104th Congress. On the operational side, I'm glad that they're finally moving out, but you know, this issue with regard to the logs, and we're going to have some testimony on the Fox vehicles, this was an issue that was covered 3 years ago by Ike Skelton when he chaired the Personnel Committee, and we got into this, and we're giving advice to the Pentagon that if you want to begin to looking at where you should see whether or not there were chemical munitions in the theater, check out the historian with the unit, whoever has these logs down at the small unit level. You know, in the press over the last week, there have been an overplay of the hands with regard to missing logs at CENTCOM. Don't let that cloud the vision here. You know, when you have a senior NBC officer at CENTCOM and you have a command structure that is placing a lot of stress, that there are no, here's the disconnect. There are no chemical munitions in the theater of operations, all right? Then why did you give so many inoculations to the soldiers? Why did you prepare us for the threat? And so we're all prepared for the threat, but you've always maintained that they weren't within the theater. That's such a tremendous disconnect. And there is a filtering process that I think will begin to develop with this testimony when they make actual positive readings, yet because of this holding on tight, based on intelligence that there were no munitions, chemical munitions in theater, that if you had a reading, then it must be a false positive. And then you have this press from chain of command downward. So by the time things actually get to the senior NBC officer at CENTCOM and whatever actually he gets into a log, it's pretty much been filtered by the time it ever gets to him. So I just wanted to share that with you, that we've visited that issue, and don't get too bent out of shape. You're saying, well, this may be the proof. I don't believe so. The foot dragging aspect of this, and I think Mr. Sanders touched on it, he's absolutely right. The issues of causation, I think we're going to continue to struggle with for quite a while. Let us never refer to this as a syndrome. It's not the Gulf War syndrome. It's Gulf War illnesses, because there are many forms, common denominators of causation with overlapping symptoms. And the pursuit with regard to the causation should be very real. What has been difficult with this process, and why I compliment this subcommittee, is that you have, where I have had to go over the wall and around the wall, you went through the wall on the issue of the chemical munitions. And I think a lot of compliment, not only to you, but a lot of compliment has to go to the veterans community and to the spouses who've pressed the issue with regard to, they've been living with the debilitating illness of their loved ones in the face of no chemical munitions. So there's a lot of compliment to go around, and you share a lot of it on this committee. But I think we're going to continue to struggle with the issues of causation on the medical side of this. Because in all the millions of dollars for which we have funded, whether it be through the Department of Defense, whether it be through the Veterans Administration, whether it be even in the private delivery systems of health, much of the research has been done at the exclusion of chemical weapons in the protocols. So it's almost as if we're having now to start over with a lot of our research. But I'm pleased that Chairman Shays has taken this ball and run with it. The only thing that we have not developed further, for which we should, is a lot of focus has now all of a sudden been placed upon chemical munitions, and it should, Mr. Shays, but what about biological? And if you gave us shots for anthrax and you gave us shots for botulism, there must have been the biological threat present in the theater. So if they're also denying biological in the face of a now admission years later with regard to chemical, I am not satisfied by saying that there were no biologicals within theater. So, you know, in the face of Boutros Boutros-Ghali just giving an okay for Iraq to now have sale of oil for humanitarian reasons without them coming forth with regard to a lot of their intelligence of biological and chemical munitions, I am distressed at the moment. I yield back the balance of my time.
I thank the gentleman and would want to make sure that, for the record, it's clear that this has really been an undertaking of the entire committee, and Mr. Towns, the ranking member, has been a proactive, equal partner in this process. I have no problem giving him the gavel at times because this has been, in fact, a bipartisan undertaking to get at the truth. And the bottom line is we're looking to properly diagnose, treat, and fairly compensate veterans who need to be compensated. And before calling our witnesses, I will point out that we will be having another hearing, our seventh hearing, on January 21st. At that time, Dr. Kenneth Kaiser, Assistant Secretary for Veterans Affairs, Head of the Healthcare for Veterans Affairs, will be coming to testify, as will Bernard Rosker, who is the Special Assistant for Gulf War Illnesses in the Office of the Secretary of Defense. So we will be having that hearing on January 21st of next month. At this time, I'm going to be, the committee is privileged to bring to testify Major Michael Johnson from the U.S. Army, Sergeant George Grass, U.S. Marine Corps, and Major Randy Hebert, who is accompanied U.S. Marine Corps, all of whom were in the Persian Gulf. Mr. Hebert is accompanied by his father, Lloyd Hebert, and his wife, Kim. And we will be having three testimonies, but in response to, I believe, Mr. Hebert, you'll be reading the testimony, and both of you will be helping your son, your husband, respond to, helping us understand his response to questions. Since you all are there, I'm going to ask those of you who can, including Mr. Hebert, the father, as well as the, Kim, his wife, to stand and be sworn in as well. And Mr. Hebert, if you can't stand, we understand. It's nice. That was your decision to stand, and we appreciate it. Thank you, sir. If you would raise your hand, your right arm. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you will give before this subcommittee will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? It's a privilege to have all of you here. You may be seated. Note for the record that all the witnesses have responded in the affirmative, and if I could, just for some bookkeeping, I ask unanimous consent that all members of the subcommittee, all members, be permitted to place an opening statement in the record and that the record remain open for 3 days for that purpose and without objection, so ordered. And I ask unanimous consent that our witnesses be permitted to include their written statements in the record as well and without objection, so ordered. And Major Johnson, we'll start with you, sir, and we'll just go right down the line.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. And again, it's a privilege to have all of you here, and we thank you for your willingness to come before this committee.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to present information on the events surrounding my unit's detection of toxic chemical warfare agents in Kuwait on 7 and 8 August 1991. I am here today in uniform at the invitation of this committee. My testimony is, however, not official Army policy, but comes from my personal experience during my tour of duty in the Persian Gulf. On those days, 7 and 8 August 1991, my unit participated in a joint chemical detection mission with the 21st British Explosive Ordnance Disposal Squadron, Royal Engineers, to identify the contents of a container suspected of containing a toxic chemical warfare agent. Our mission was to confirm or deny the presence of chemical agents in the container. I was the commander of the 54th Chemical Troop and would lead the U.S. portion of the mission. We began by conducting leaders' reconnaissance of the area where the container was located. We then conducted back briefs to the Chief of Security Assistance and Senior Defense Representative, United States Embassy, Kuwait, on our plan to execute the mission. On 8 August 1991, we moved to the site with two Fox nuclear biological and chemical reconnaissance vehicles. We conducted 21 tests of the substance in the container. The British conducted 17 of the tests, and my unit, or my Fox teams, conducted the remaining four tests. Based on our analysis of the liquid in the container, we confirmed the presence of a blister agent, commonly referred to as mustard or HD, traces of phosgene, a non-persistent choking agent, and traces of phosgene oxime, a non-persistent blistering agent. While on the site, I observed a British soldier come in contact with the liquid while working to take a sample collection for transport out of the area. I personally observed the liquid effects on his wrist and concluded that he was exposed to a blistering agent based on the reaction of the liquid to skin contact. The soldier was decontaminated and transported to a hospital for medical treatment. To date, I have no information concerning the health condition of that soldier that was contaminated. After completing the mission, and once the Fox vehicles were decontaminated, I was instructed to remove the tapes from the mobile mass spectrometer on the Fox vehicle. The tapes were to be further analyzed along with the samples that were removed from the area by personnel in desert uniforms. I had no idea who these personnel were or what organization they represented. I was later given a Be Prepared mission to provide support to the British in their efforts to move the container out of the area for destruction. We never executed that mission. I was told by my chain of command that we would not conduct the mission and that the British had complete control of the container. Before departing Kuwait for our return back to our home base in Fulda, Germany, I did not receive any information on the final outcome of the analyzed samples that were taken from the area. These are the facts as I observed them on 7 and 8 August 1991. My written testimony goes into greater detail on the specifics of my unit's actions in accomplishing the mission to confirm or deny the presence of toxic chemical warfare agents. Mr. Chairman, I ask that the testimony or the document that Mr. Tutti provided be submitted into the record to support my testimony. Mr. Chairman, I appreciate the opportunity to appear before this committee to share my personal experience in the Persian Gulf. Mr. Chairman, I am prepared to answer your questions.
Thank you, Major. We're going to defer questions until all the witnesses in this panel have given their testimony. This time, Sergeant Grass.
My name is Gunnery Sergeant Grass. I'm currently a member of the Marine Corps Chemical Biological Incident Response Force, based at Camp Lejeune, North Carolina. While I was assigned to Southwest Asia, I was assigned as a Fox Vehicle Commander for Task Force Ripper, 1st Marine Division. I was further assigned to 3rd Tank Battalion, which was going to be the lead element of Task Force Ripper. My mission was to observe or confirm or deny the presence of nuclear, biological, and chemicals used on the battlefield in such case. My first job was to, as I was processing through the breaches, was to check all the lanes on the first belt and the second belt of the breach of the minefields. Going through the first minefield breach, we detected small traces of nerve agent. I reported that back as small detections, although there was not enough concentration in the air for me to be able to run a full spectrum on the mass spectrometer. Once we had taken Jabber Airfield, I was positioned just north of there, and my alarm went off on my Fox vehicle with a full concentration of sulfur mustard. I printed out that spectrum. We did a background check. We also had put in there samples of the oil fire vapors that were in the air, so we knew that there was no way that that could conflict with the sulfur mustard reading. I tried to pass that up my chain of command, but they continually told Chief Warrant Officer Biedenbender, who was the NBC officer at 3rd Tank Battalion, that it had to have been false readings from the Amtraks and the tanks that were around me. I told them, no, that comes up as fat oil wax and several other possible false positives they were saying, and we still said that there was no way that that could happen because we did our thorough checks, we did the background checks, we did everything we were supposed to do according to the ways that we were taught on how to run that mass spectrometer. Once we got up to Kuwait City, and after a Task Force Tripper had taken the international airport, and we were sitting, my job was to travel and verify. The Iraqi EPWs had given our intelligence personnel information saying that there was possible chemical weapons stored in the 3rd Armored Corps' ASP semi-circling Kuwait City. My job was to go find those chemical weapons. I must say that I spent years as a 6 years as an ammunition technician. I've been through the Army Technical Escort School. Prior to going to the Persian Gulf, I was a non-commissioned officer of an offensive chemical weapons unit, and I know what chemical weapons look like. And I've received, stored, issued, inventory, filled, built chemical weapons, and I know what they look like, and I know how to store them. In this one particular area, there was built up berms. There were various different 55-gallon drums stored all over the place inside this area. As I was driving through this area, the alarm on the mass spectrometer went off with a full reading of sulfur mustard. We saw the weapons that were sitting there. They were 155 rounds with bands around them. They also had skull and crossbones tapes with red and yellow tape around them. They were from the United States. A little bit farther along in the same ammunition storage area, my mass spectrometer alarm went off.
You say they were from the United States?
Yes, sir.
The Iraqi weapons?
Yes, sir.
But they were U.S.?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Throughout the whole ammunition storage area, there was weapons there from United States, Jordan, and Holland. The next, a little ways away from there, my mass spectrometer alarm went off again, and it showed a full reading of HT mustard. We backed up to the bunkers there, and there were rounds that were all boxed up in ammo boxes again. A little bit farther through this area here, in a metal-looking container, I had received another alarm went off on the mass spectrometer, and this one was for the incapacitating agent, benzyl bromide. I reported all this information back to Chief Warrant Officer Cottrell, who was the NBC officer of Task Force Ripper. When I got back to Task Force Ripper's main, myself, Chief Warrant Officer Cottrell, and other officers went into a tent. I briefed those on the readings that I had gotten back at Jabber Airfield, and also the sulfur mustard, HT mustard, benzene bromide that I just received right at the ammunition storage area outside Kuwait City. I explained to them about the atomic mass and atomic weight over 300. I explained to them other readings that were on the spectrometer tickets. They all agreed that an EOD team, explosive ordnance disposal team, should go check this area out. The next day, I escorted this EOD team that had flown up from Jabber Airfield. They had stated that they had never came forward from Jabber Airfield until that point right there. I escorted those people out to this chemical weapons storage area. They got in and they donned their full protective equipment, went inside there and they began to catalog the lot numbers because they were more concerned about these lot numbers coming into Iraq after the sanctions were imposed. Once they had finished checking the area they were in there for about an hour or so, they came back out and decontaminated themselves. I took them back to the International Airport where I had first received them, and that's the last time I saw them. I gave the mass spectrometer tickets to Chief Warrant Officer Cottrell and the rest of my chain of command, and I have not seen these tickets since. And, sir, I'd be willing to answer any questions that you may have, sir.
Thank you, Sergeant. We'll be asking you some questions. I'm going to refer to Mr. Abart as the father and the son as Major. Major Abart, your testimony will be read by your dad, is that correct?
My son would like to make the opening statement.
He is allowed and welcome to make any comments he wants, and we are as patient as can be, so he doesn't need to rush. You don't need to rush, Major.
Mr. Chairman, my son has said, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Randy Hebert. I appreciate the opportunity to present the truth today. In December 1990, I was assigned to 2nd Combat Engineer Battalion, 2nd Marine Division, where I served as Assistant Operations Officer, and Officer in Charge of breaching the division's left flank to create two emergency lanes to evacuate casualties if needed. On 23rd February 1991, the eve prior to our ground attack, we moved into our attack position approximately two and one half to 3 miles from the border of Kuwait, near the area known as the Elbow, Gader oil fields. On G-Day, 24 February 1991, we were to link up with a section of tanks. This never happened. In the confusion, I radioed to the Battalion 3 to let him know the situation. I decided to halt my men south of the berm dividing Saudi Arabia and Kuwait. I proceeded about 500 meters to the east via Humvee with my driver and radio man to a traffic control point. As we approached, we received the hand and arm signal for chemical attack. We put on our mask and gloves. In doing so, I recall my right hand feeling cool and tingling. I was mad because we were just starting and already receiving the signs for chemicals. I jumped from the vehicle and asked the MP in strong Marine Corps language who had told him to go to MOP level 4. He pointed to another Marine whom I asked the same question. He told me, someone on the radio. We drove back and radioed to my Marines to get to MOP level 4. When we arrived, some were, others were not. The driver and I jumped from the vehicle, given the signals for chemicals. I approached the MP controlling traffic to ask why he wasn't in MOP level 4. He told me the alarm was false. I was angry and removed my mask. I now feel that was a mistake. I radioed to the Battalion 3 and told him, we are rolling and we have not made contact with the tanks. He said, okay. Within a minute of rolling, he called back, saying that your lane is dirty, chemical mine has gone off, go to MOP 4. I called back and verified his statement. Then I told him, roger that. We all went to MOP 4. Lane Red 1 was the lane where the chemical mine detonated. After about 30 minutes, we had finished firing line charges. We had several mines that needed to be cleared from the hedgerow. We were still in MOP 4, and I radioed to the Battalion 3 asking where we would decontaminate. A lieutenant told me that we should check to see if chemicals were in the air. I again asked where we would decontaminate. I received the same response. I was mad and hung up. We stayed in MOP 4 another 2.5 to 3 hours. During this time, much of the division moved quickly through the area, some in MOP 4, others not. Although we had finished our portion of the lane, we remained by lane red 1 because the far right flank was having great difficulty due to the density of the minefield. The battalion commander wanted us all to proceed to the next obstacle belt together. I remember a dead camel lying by the entrance to our lane. It did not have any insects feeding on it. After several hours in MOP 4, I had my driver check the area for chemicals. After we determined that chemicals were no longer present, my driver selectively unmasked. Then after he displayed no symptoms, I had my other Marines unmasked. I forgot to mention that once we arrived at the breach site, I had communicated directly with the lieutenant working with me, asking if he felt funny or if he was having problems breathing. He told me he didn't think so, but he asked why. I told him that I felt funny. I also recall two large explosions while we were breaching that I thought were artillery. However, they only left dust clouds after they hit. I now believe they may have been chemical rounds. We remained between the two minefields the night of 24 February 1991 and the next day and night, 25 February 1991. On the 25th, I heard a large explosion in the area. The following day, we moved to an area known as the Ice Cube Tray, where we built a POW camp. I later learned the area just north was the headquarters for the Iraqi Chemical Brigade. During our movement to this area, we heard several explosions. I am not sure what they were. A few days later, 28 February 1991, we moved to an area about 8 miles southwest of Kuwait City near a small town called Al-Jarrah. I later learned this area was an old garbage dump that had been covered. Around the beginning of March, perhaps the 10th, I became very ill with flu-like symptoms. I remember many others were ill also. Around the 22nd of February, I started taking paracetamol, bromide pills, PB, for an anti-nerve agent protection. I believe I took the pills for 11 to 14 days. Once we returned to Saudi Arabia in April, early April, I began to have some difficulty with sleep. This continued upon my return home on 15 May 1991 until early July, at which time I was having difficulty reading and remembering what I had read. I was extremely aggressive, moody, and excitable. I had headaches, vomiting, and diarrhea. I was also diagnosed with moderate depression. I was given medications for several months, at which time the majority of the symptoms went away. I continued to have headaches almost on a daily basis and took as many as 8 to 10 aspirins a day until April 1995. Besides the headaches, I felt I was not able to breathe as well when I ran. In May of 1994, I noticed a decrease in my upper body strength. In early July, I had a lump on my throat area the size of a walnut. I was not sick. I had a friend who is a medical doctor come to my house, to my home to examine me. He was not sure what caused the lump. It remained for 1.5 to 2 weeks. In October of 1994, I experienced problems with my throat muscles and coughed very frequently and uncontrollably. There were times when my throat muscles would constrict and I could not breathe for 10 to 15 seconds. In November of the same year, I noticed atrophy in my right arm and hand and began having difficulty controlling my hand and arm. In January 1995, while being evaluated at the National Naval Medical Center, I developed another lump on the right side of my face, just forward of my right ear. It also was the size of a walnut. During the same 3-week period, I had a very large rash from the middle of my nose to the middle of my forehead, which was red, swollen, and extremely itchy. Also, it had 3 white, watery pustules. When the rash subsided, I was left with a scar in between my eyebrows. From January 1995 until October 1995, I was evaluated at several different hospitals. During some of these visits, I saw, spoke to, and learned of other service men and women who serve in the Gulf who were having problems. These problems included cancer, respiratory disease, muscle twitches, fatigue, memory loss, joint pains, ulcers, rashes, lumps under the skin, hearing problems, atrophy of one limb, atrophy of the brain, insomnia, depression, heart problems, tearing of the eyes, and others. During this time, I developed a rash on my buttocks, tearing of the eyes with burning, and occasional ringing in both ears. In October 1995, I was diagnosed with ALS, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, also known as Lou Gehrig's disease. I believe the medical problems I have discussed are due to low-level chemical exposure over an extended period. I learned after the war that the chemical mine detonated in Lane Red 1 was confirmed for the nerve agent sarin and also the agent Lewisite mustard gas by a Fox vehicle in the lane. I also learned that 2 Marines and an Amtrak received chemical burns and that the chemical mine confirmation was reported by the regimental commander of the 6th Marines. It was also reported up the chain of command by the 2nd Marine Division commander. It has been brought to my attention that there have been at least 7 other cases of ALS in service members who served in the Gulf. To me, this is more than chance or coincidence. Besides myself, there have been numerous others with various experiences. For example, 1, I have spoken to a Marine who believes a missile attack occurred in Al-Jabal that was a chemical attack. He made the duty officer from the 2nd Division read the division log book to him. He has the statement recorded on audio tape. It says that mustard gas was detected. 2, I have also spoken to a Marine who was evaluated with several other Marines from his squad upon their return from the war. They were told they were being studied for it. Adverse effects from the desert sun. They were told this by someone whom he believes was a civilian doctor. They all were observed for 1 week. The following week, the Marines went back to the hospital to find the results. They were told that they were never there. Also, there is not an indication in their records they were ever there. Three, I have learned of a Marine Corps investigation that was directed at the general officer level to determine the possible exposure to chemical agents of Marine Sergeant Randy G. Wheeler. As a result of that investigation, I have learned of other chemical detections just to our northeast near Al Jaber Airfield in the 1st Marine Division's area, both on the 24th and 25th of February, 1991. One of the opinions of the general officer reviewing the investigation was that Sergeant Wheeler may be suffering from exposure to chemicals or other contaminants, and his condition may be combat related. Finally, on 12 November 1996, the commandant of the Marine Corps was speaking at Camp Lejeune. I had an opportunity to ask him if the Marine Corps had an official position on Gulf War syndrome illness. The commandant told me that the Marine Corps does have a position and they believe chemical weapons were used. He also said the Marine Corps is in the process of trying to contact Marines who may have been exposed. In conclusion, I believe with 100% certainty that chemicals and possibly biological agents were used during the war. I base my belief on several facts. One, Iraq had the capability and resources to deploy chemical weapons and had done so in the past. Two, the United States was primarily concerned with the enemy's use of chemical and biological weapons, both prior to the start of the air war and the ground war. Three, the primary targets during the air campaign were chemical munition plants and storage areas. Four, prior to the ground campaign, we were all told to expect chemical attacks. Five, Fox vehicles, extremely sophisticated pieces of detection equipment, were tested by General Dynamics only days before the ground war. Six, the Fox vehicles were operated by highly skilled, professionally trained individuals. Seven, Fox vehicles confirmed chemical agents in several locations. Eight, many service members became ill with flu-like symptoms shortly after the ground war. These symptoms are consistent with research findings of low-level chemical exposure. Nine, other countries detected chemicals in the theater. The Czechoslovakians are considered the best in the world at chemical detection. They detected chemicals. 10, individuals received blisters and burns consistent with chemical exposure. 11, close to 100,000 men and women are now sick with many different ailments which are consistent with research on low-level chemical exposure. 12, chemical alarms sounded throughout the theater of operation. 13, the Pentagon has changed its position on chemical detections. 14, there were dead animals and insects throughout the theater consistent with chemical exposure. 15, colonels and generals in the Marine Corps, including the commandant, believe chemical weapons were used. 16, I was extremely healthy and fit prior to the war. Over the last 5.5 years, I have experienced most of the symptoms as known as Gulf War syndrome. This concludes my statement to the committee. I would be glad to answer any questions that you might have. Very respectfully, Major Randy L. Hebert.
Thank you, Major, for your very helpful testimony. Before I call on Mr. Sanders to start the line of questioning, I would like to just set for the record a definition of MOP 4 for the testimony for the record. I would invite anyone to describe what that was.
Sir, MOP 4 stands for Mission-Oriented Protective Posture, and it consists of a chemical protective overgarment, which is a charcoal-impregnated suit for your tops, for your jacket, and your trousers. You also wear a pair of rubber booties over there covering the combat boots. You wear a pair of rubber gloves covering your hands, and you wear a field protective mask.
My understanding, that's the highest level that you would go to. You're in full protective gear, correct, sir?
Yes, sir. In a military environment, yes, sir.
Yes. I'd also like to add that in that MOP posture, you have a range of MOP 0 to MOP level 4, 0 being the lowest of it, not wearing the uniform. And as you go up to each level, up to MOP 4, you add a piece of that garment on. So when you hear us say full MOP, we're also meaning full MOP 4, protective mask, gloves, booties, the actual overgarment on, zipped up with our other detection tapes on our uniforms.
Now, for the record, both you, Major, and you, Gunnery Sergeant, were in Fox equipment. You were basically ahead of the charge. Is that correct?
With my detections, I was not actually inside the vehicle. I was 100 to 150 meters to the northeast of where the container was located at a location called the initial command post that was set up by the British. So I was outside of the vehicles. However, I had radio communication with both vehicles and could talk as I'm talking with you to each member in that vehicle to find out exactly what was going on inside the vehicle and what tasks, what findings they had discovered at any given point during that mission.
Just for the record, both of you in the Fox equipment in those units, how often were you in full protective gear? During
my unit's detection, we were at the command post. We were not in any increased MOP posture, basically because the commander had identified a location that was upwind from where the actual container was, so that if any vapors were released into the atmosphere, they would float downwind from us, away from our position. Inside our Fox vehicles, as a battle drill, as another precaution, if our overpressure system failed inside the system, my soldiers were already at a level called MOP level 2, where they already had the overgarment on, zipped up. The only thing they did not have on was the protective mask and the gloves. So if vapor was able to escape and make it inside the vehicle, they would have had enough time, based on the other detection systems inside the vehicle, to go to full MOP 4 to protect themselves as well as continue on with their mission.
Sergeant Grass, were you in the vehicle, therefore not fully under protective gear, or were you in both conditions?
Well, sir, my Fox vehicle was positioned on the forward element. The units that were in front of me was the tow vehicles because it had a better one-on-one contact with the tank fighting against the tow. It was also the Mark 19 vehicles were in front of me. I was positioned back, just a little bit back from those forward of the tanks. I had everybody's frequencies and call signs, so anywhere within Task Force Ripper, whether it be 1st Battalion, 7th Marines, or 1st Battalion, 5th Marines, and so on, if there was a chemical attack or nuclear, biological, or chemical attack, then they just basically contacted me, and I went straight to their area with my security. To answer the other question, sir, we had the choice, just like the Major did. The overpressure system inside the Fox vehicle prevented chemicals from coming in. In the case that I had to open up the top of the vehicle and return fire with the machine gun on top, then yes, sir, we would also have been in MOP level 2 inside that vehicle.
Basically, I've really proceeded in asking a line of questioning, so I thought I was just going to establish something for the record. I'm just going to continue for two more minutes here. My sense is, though, what I'm just trying to understand, I consider this more housekeeping than really getting into the nuts and bolts of what we want to ask you. What I'm trying to visualize is that when you are out to test something, by the time the alarm goes off, isn't it too late?
There's no purpose to get outside that Fox vehicle, sir. Okay. It's fully enclosed, and everything can be ran from inside.
Now, Fox vehicles preceded Major Hebert and his unit, and it's your testimony, Major Hebert, that Fox equipment that preceded your units were alerting you to chemical agents.
He was in the first wave with six Marines.
Thank you. Mr. Sanders, we'll proceed with questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and it goes without saying that all of us are very thankful for all of you being here today and giving us the information that you have. We appreciate it. It seems to be that a common thread running through all of your testimony is that you had difficulty communicating, or lack of success, if you like, communicating your experience to your higher-ups. Now, it seems fairly obvious that if one wants to understand the problems associated with the illnesses that our soldiers are experiencing, the more information that we have, the better we can deal with the problem. That's true for any problem. It took 5 years before the Pentagon finally acknowledged that our soldiers were exposed to chemical agents. In your judgment, given your particular difficulties in being able to communicate your own experiences to the higher-ups, why do you think it took 5 years before the Pentagon finally acknowledged what you have told us today and what many other people have told us? And anyone in any order, please answer.
Mr. Sir, on my part, I think it was maybe a lack of understanding of the seriousness behind what information was being presented 5 years ago. My intent was to provide my supervisors with information about our actions in the desert, with the hope of being able to go and teach our lessons learned from the Gulf. Because at the time that I submitted my report, I was an instructor at the infantry school at Fort Benning, and I thought what a great opportunity it would be to present that type of information, because in all the classes that I taught on NBC, I also began to hear a lot of common things coming back from officers who had participated in the Gulf War. Confidence in the equipment, confidence in the soldiers who were actually utilizing that equipment. It, to me, was the best atmosphere to give them reassurance that our equipment was the best at that time, and it still is today, and that we could continue on by educating everybody, in this case in the infantry school, with the advanced course officers, young lieutenants and captains that were coming through. When the report went forward, it came back to me with great information, go ahead and modify your classes to talk about those topics. But I think as far as it going any farther than that, to me, it would have been maybe, I just don't fully understand what's in my hands coming from the supervisors.
So Major, you really don't have a good answer, I think, as to why it took 5 years.
Yes, sir. Yes, yeah. Sir.
Would somebody else like to respond?
If I say your question.
If he understands your question. You want to know why the Pentagon took 5 years?
I tell you why the Pentagon. My belief is the Pentagon knew from day one.
His belief is the Pentagon knew from day one. That chemicals were used
in the theater.
And the reason that he says that.
And then they have a reason to cover the truth.
They have a reason to cover the truth.
It's because they have been so in the past to memories of World War II.
They have done so in the past with World War II.
Veterans. With Agent Orange. Vietnam. And the main reason is it boils down to money.
The main reason it boils down to money. They don't want to be held responsible.
For only people who are now sick.
For all the people who are now sick.
And for
the ones that have already died.
Gunnery Sergeant, thank you very much, Major. Gunnery Sergeant, did you want to give a thought on that?
Sir, my chain of command began with Chief Warrant Officer Cottrell, who appeared in front of the committee. I saw him when I was with 3rd Marine Division on Okinawa in January 1993. At that moment right there, I immediately let my chain of command know that he was talking about his Fox vehicle. So that's when an investigation that Major Ebert was mentioning about General Christmas' investigation on Randy Wheeler. Randy Wheeler was one of the security that was attached with me. So when I appeared in front of the advisory committee in May, they asked me why it's taken me so long from January 1993 until May of this year to appear in front of a committee, and my answer to them was, I don't know why. Once the questioning was over, and I had listened to the Department of Defense investigative military personnel, I had mentioned to them out in the hallway that I have information that can help them with their investigation. I gave them the names of Master Sergeant Bradford, who was the Fox Vehicle Commander for 6th Marines, that to this day has not been asked a question. I gave them the information about the Fox Vehicle Commander that was back at Jebel that would chase the Scuds that had possible chemical contamination. And I gave them the Fox Vehicle Commanders for several other the task forces within 1st and 2nd Marine Divisions, and they have not been contact to this date. So, sir, my answer is I'm not sure.
I don't want to put you on the spot. You can decline a comment. But do you agree with Major Hebert that, in fact, perhaps the Pentagon did know from day one that chemical agents were used and for whatever reason chose not to make that public?
Sir, the Fox, I'll answer that in my style of answer, sir. The Fox vehicles were checked by General Dynamics. They entrusted a lot of Marines, sailors, airmen, soldiers' lives with the Fox vehicles and the crews that ran them. If the vehicles were false and the crews were not trained properly, then that's one thing. But the crews were well trained. That's why they were chosen by whatever Department of Defense service they were from, because of their knowledge of nuclear, biological, and chemical weapons. Personally, the chemical weapons storage area outside Kuwait City as I stated in my opening statement, I know what a chemical weapon storage area looks like, and I know what chemical weapons look like. And that's my answer, sir.
Okay. Major, do you want to revisit that question? What's your feeling about what the Major Hebert said? Do you have
a
thought on it?
Sir, I was not there during the air or ground war. However, where I was located at, I thought at the time that that they in fact had used chemical weapons or had employed them, and that was based purely on the fact that alarms were going off, detections were being made, and the individuals who were actually responsible for manning those detection systems knew what they were doing. So I thought that they had.
Is it your impression that they did know?
At that time, it was my impression that they had employed chemical weapons.
My last question, with your permission, Mr. Chairman. It appears, and one of the frustrating things that many of us and you and the country are dealing with is that more information seems to be eking out month after month. Is it your judgment that up to this point there has been full disclosure on the magnitude of possible chemical exposures, or do you think we're going to be hearing more in the coming weeks and months and perhaps years? Who would like the Major?
His opinion? In his opinion, we'll be finding out a lot more information in the over the next several months.
And also, there will be many more veterans.
And there'll be many more veterans
that become ill.
Because of the low-level chemical exposure.
And we have seen
over the last 3 years. We have seen the number of veterans
who are ill
increase dramatically.
Thank you very much. Did either of you gentlemen want to comment on that briefly?
Sir, I think that we will see in the months to come more information being presented, that exposure to chemical agents is possible that it actually happened. I think more veterans will present more information on their personal experiences during that time period, both during and after the ground campaign.
Thank you, Major. Gunnery Sergeant, did you want to?
Sir, I think that if the attitude of the committee, just like in a court of law, is that you're innocent until proven guilty, that if the committee takes a positive approach with the thought that there possibly was exposure to chemical agents or there was exposure to chemical or biological agents, instead of taking the approach that it's not and going from the negative aspect and then taking this from the positive aspect and then checking all avenues of approach, and I think that others will start coming forward and admitting that some of these people were exposed to chemical agents over there.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Steve, you want to do it? With Mr. Fattah's permission, being a member of the committee, he's going to give Mr. Bouye a chance to ask a question.
Yield immediately back to you. I have to leave, and I apologize to my comrades for that. I think that Mr. Sanders is right on point, but the Department of Defense, to my knowledge, has not given the admission that chemical weapons were used during the war. They've given the admission with regard to Camisilla, but we shouldn't move out on the presumption that they are accepting this testimony as fact. And that's what is very, very difficult and very challenging for us, Mr. Sanders, is that this testimony that we just now received is no different from a lot of testimony that has been given to us on many different subcommittees, but the powers that be in the Pentagon are not accepting the word of these men. And that is very bothersome. So they've given the admission of Camisilla. They're not giving this as an admission of fact that chemical weapons were used in the theater. They're not even claiming that chemical mines were even used. That he keeps saying, well, there is no evidence, yet when we have soldiers that give oral testimony, have logs, have the Fox vehicles, and yet are still stonewalling, foot dragging, and that kind of thing. So Godspeed to you, and keep it up, and your testimony, and matter of fact, your presence, we'll keep this going in the National Security Committee. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank the gentleman. Mr. Fattah?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Firstly, I just want to try to put this in some context, at least for myself and perhaps for others. The United States knew that during the Iran-Iraq war that chemical weapons had been used. And as the process for the beginning of Desert Shield moved forward in Desert Storm, there was clearly throughout the ranks an understanding that if we were going to deploy troops, that there was a possibility that there could be use of chemical and biological warfare weapons. And that's why there were even statements as to make sure that we were well prepared. So it is perhaps confusing to the public, given the knowledge of Iraq's use of these weapons in their conflict with Iran and statements that were made then by both President Bush, Secretary of Defense Cheney, the head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Colin Powell, Schwarzkopf, and all involved, that we were very concerned about this whole issue as we proceeded forward. That, you know, the reluctance of the Department of Defense in the way that this information has been processed up to date really and is a strongly contradictory to the concerns as illustrated by those facts from the beginning. Now, the commissaire we've heard about, we've heard now from people who have been trained by the armed forces, Commander Johnson, is it?
Major Johnson. Yes,
Major
sir.
Johnson. You are trained as an expert in this area in terms of nuclear, biological, and chemical agents. Is that correct?
Yes, sir, that's correct.
Now, when you were in Kuwait, you indicated that you were assigned to confirm or deny in a particular instance whether or not there were chemical agents. After your work was completed, you said you gave tapes to people who were in desert uniforms.
Yes, sir.
And they took those tapes. And you cannot identify at this point who those people were. Were they Americans? Were they British troops? Or,
I thought that either they were American or British. During that operation, I had no contact, meaning verbal contact with those individuals because I was more
concerned. Following orders.
I was following orders, and I was concerned about the men that I had in those vehicles. So the only thing that was on my mind was ensuring that they were continuing to do the mission right, and that their safety was number one. And so I focused on that. And after completion of the mission, I followed orders from the senior representative on the ground, the U.S. representative under my chain of command. I responded to his orders.
Let me ask you a question, given your expertise. The Fox detection vehicles and the concern about positive or false readings, if it were the case that there was some question about whether or not a reading, a detection was false or positive, wouldn't it be your instructions always to act as if the reading was positive until it was verified to be false?
Sir, and that's why we continue. Yes, to answer your question, yes, sir. In order to ensure that we verify the presence or confirm the presence of an agent, that's the reason why I had two vehicles present. They were on two different radio frequencies. I had the ability to communicate to both. I wanted to ensure that, one, that the first Fox, if it was successful in detecting an agent, the other crew, the second crew that was in a down position, would not hear what was coming over the net, therefore create some type of bias or some motivation in their part to say, we have to find something as well. So I kept them on two different frequencies, and then we ran the test twice with each vehicles, and they both registered with the same chemical compounds.
Now the CIA was brought in to do an examination. They issued a report saying that there was, as I remember the last hearing, Mr. Chairman, that they felt there were no chemical agents in the field, and. We, Sergeant Gress, you said that your job, as in layman's terms, was that you were supposed to make sure that it was, as these minefields were being cleared out, that there were no chemicals that were being exploded as you cleared the minefield that would endanger troops that were going to be following you. Is that fairly an accurate description of what your mission was?
Sir, during the breaching operations, I sat and I watched the line charges from the combat engineers shoot across the minefields. Once they had shot across and then the mine plow went across, my job was to drive down that lane checking for either liquid or chemical contamination. And I checked all eight lanes.
I think we're saying the same thing. Now, what I'm concerned about, and I know that in the midst of a war, things are not as neat as, you know, we might suspect. But there seems to be, from your testimony, clear indications that the level of communications back and forth about whether or not there were chemicals was at best misleading at times and perhaps jeopardized soldiers as they proceeded forward, because as you indicated in your testimony, there were radio communications that indicated positive, and then there was lack of clarity. There were people who were moving into MOP 4, and there were people who were not, and there was seemed to be a lot of confusion. One of the things that hopefully, you know, this committee doesn't have jurisdiction over DOD, but obviously one of the things that we should be concerned about is, as we go forward, that type of communications difficulty be worked out to the benefit of the soldiers involved. Until it's clear one way or the other whether it is a false indication or a positive indication. Now, I want to move quickly as possible, Mr. Chairman.
Just clarify one point. The full committee of government reform has oversight of DOD.
The subcommittee.
And our chairman has given us the authorization, and that's why DOD has appeared before us.
I was not suggesting
I just don't want the DOD to get a comfort level that they may not be invited to continue to participate with this committee.
Thank you. But I did want to, by way of that bridge, asks, because one of the items under this subcommittee's jurisdiction, particular jurisdiction ongoingly, is the VA, is to ask of the major whether or not DOD's official opinion that no exposures had occurred in their previous position, whether that had affected your ability to receive treatment from the VA.
My husband is still on active duty, sir.
So the VA doesn't come into play.
So the VA has not come into play at all at this point.
Okay, thank you very much. Let me just say that in conclusion then, that Mr. Chairman, one of the items that has become clear through some of the other testimony is that we have to be concerned that notwithstanding these official pronouncements that care from the VA be afforded to each and every veteran that presents himself and is possibly been exposed to low-level contamination. And finally, I just think that the Congress, even though this subcommittee has been very aggressive, that it's clear to me that the public should demand that we actually be even more aggressive on this matter in the 105th Congress, not just this subcommittee, and not just hearing from people like the people here, but higher ups
And I know that we want the DOD to come forward, but I would also indicate that there were people in upper echelons of this government during this period of time, like Secretary Cheney and others, who I think in Schwarzkopf and Colin Powell, who we should attempt to understand whether the major is correct or not. And that is whether or not on day one there was information that could have aided in providing adequate care and knowledge about this. And I think that we should be as serious in that investigation as this Congress has been looking into other matters of interest to the Congress. We've been very aggressive on some matters, and I'd like to see our chairman have this subcommittee's inquiry be expanded in a much more aggressive manner, because I think this subcommittee's carried the weight, but there's more here that we should examine. Thank you.
I thank the gentleman. We have a number of other questions that we're going to ask. I want to just establish a little bit of history here, and also to state for the record that operation of the chairman of the full committee and full jurisdiction to have DOD, the CIA, and VA, the Veterans Affairs Department, for this committee. And we're not going to allow for a minute the kind of problem that we've encountered for 5 years, and that is DOD does its thing, CIA does its thing, the VA does its thing, and they don't seem to talk. We get, and we have in the past, get all parties in the same table so we can compare testimony. I need to say this for the record again. All three are going to be invited. In fact, DOD is coming to this committee in January. The DOD, Mr. Joseph, was here previous. He will be in, pointed out. And we are going to get, and the CIA was here. In my memory is the CIA saying they never once spoke to our own troops, from our own troops, vital information. They saw their job as going to other people outside our own government, and they said whatever they got from the DOD was the information they accepted. And just reading, frankly, the New York Times today, we have got to get beyond the point where we have certain information. Your testimony is vital to this committee. I don't accept for a minute a comment that this is information that we have continually had. Very document. And every hearing we're going to have veterans come, because you all are wilderness that nobody's been listening to, and you're the first people that you listen to, and you are the experts. And when I read with Colin Powell and Mr. Schwarzkopf, their names, talking, alarms went off all the time. But in essence, since no one dropped dead, I didn't think there was a problem. I mean, of my take of their view. And that just, it just defies logic. After World War I, that we had some troops who died instantly from nerve gas, muscle gas, right? We knew that some came home, and years later they became ill and died. And we had to accept the fact, and they weren't treated, they weren't cared for, treated. But we knew after World War I there was acute. And then we knew there was low-level exposure that led to ultimately chronic illness, that led and we learned that with nuclear, our whole warfare and the soldiers that cleaned the planes when they dropped the bombs for testing, who became sick and died years later from exposure then, but not an acute illness then. And we learned from So, I mean, this is old stuff for us. And I just want to say to you, you all have taken some risk. You are all soldiers in our military. You are active soldiers in our military. But you believe in the code that you swore to. And that code, superiors need, you come forward. And you're very brave people. And believe that your superior officers respect you for what you're doing, but you are giving a contrary view. And this is why your testimony here is so vital. So vital. Now, Mr. Grass, Gunnery Sergeant Grass, I want to be clear. Let me just preface these comments by saying the only acknowledgement true is Camisea. And that's the reason why I think we have that is that one of your comrades, one of your brothers stepped forward and basically had pictures of the plumes and had pictures of some of the weapons. At 4:00 on a Friday afternoon before our Tuesday hearing, did the Department of Defense have a press conference to acknowledge that our troops may have been exposed at Camisea? Only then, and it was one of your soldiers that basically forced the DOD to act. So we're going to get to the point where we're going to have the truth be known. Now, what I need to be clear on is you are an expert. Is that correct, Sergeant Grass? You are a trained person in chemical weapons. Is that right? To identify them and to detect them.
Yes, sir.
Now, for the record, it's my understanding that biological agents can't be detected by the Fox equipment or any other equipment. Is that correct or not?
The Fox vehicle can take a sample, but they have to give that sample to somebody else. There is biological identification equipment tested, such as in Utah, that being a member of the Chemical Biological Incident Response Force, I'm privy to that information right now. It's still they're still looking at biological detection, sir.
Now, we had Fox equipment that would detect chemical agents. We also had other equipment that weren't part of the Fox. Is that correct? That would also detect chemical agents.
Yes, sir. You have the M8 alarm. You have the M256. You have M8 paper. You have the chemical agent monitor.
The most reliable, though, would be what's on your units. Or did others? In other words, the soldiers who weren't part of a Fox unit detect chemical agents.
Yes, sir. With different varying. Yes.
We have soldiers who have said these alarms went off all the time. We even have the highest in command. What is your reaction to their comment that basically we discounted them? What's the logic behind discounting them, as far as you understand it? Thousands of alarms went off during the course of the war and afterwards.
My guess is that they were exposed to some low level of chemical.
Okay. Johnson, Major Johnson? I mean, my point is, when you hear superior officers basically say they went off all the time and we discounted them, what's your, and data that came from Fox equipment, from Fox units, which I would consider, what was your reaction?
My reaction, sir, was it was hard to believe that all the alarms, that the other detection equipment, like the gunnery sergeant mentioned, gave false readings. Based on my knowledge of chemical or of MBC, that I know that the equipment that we have is designed to detect, and that the soldiers that are in control of those detection pieces. I believe that when they said detections happen, they happen.
I was trying to put myself in your position. I was thinking that if I was doing my job and I gave it to superior officers, basically why I'm even there. I mean, what's the point? What's the point of having the equipment if we're not going to listen? What's the point of having the Fox units if we're not going to pay attention to it? What was your reaction? I mean, do you I would think of it?
Yes, sir. My reaction during our detections was that everyone there believed. When I informed the senior leadership there that we had detected chemicals, we moved the vehicle to a contamination-free area, and I was instructed to remove the vehicle. They looked at me, they looked at my soldiers, and when you looked at those soldiers, they were confident and they knew that they had detected chemical agents. Everyone had that system, the FOX, worked, and that thought that it worked properly. And there was no doubt in anybody's mind chemicals that I had mentioned earlier were actually found.
At what level did you have those detections?
At micro levels, very low level readings that were in the soil initially when we moved into the area. It's one of our tasks before we move into an area to check it, we start our up until the point where we actually go to a point survey where the vehicles are in a static position. They detected micro levels of mustard, and then when the actual container open and liquid was withdrawn and it was applied to the mobile mass spectrometer and the readings came up, they were readings on a scale of 8, where we identified that there were 6.4 bars, meaning a highly volatile chemical warfare agent, a blister agent, present with some trace chemical agents.
Did you take a sample that was ultimately given to the Chemical and Biological Defense Establishment of Great Britain?
I did not know. I did not submit anything to that agency you just mentioned. I did not even know that the Porton Downs in the UK until they notified me to question me about my my report, to dispute my findings in the report.
So, but the Great Britain, their unit disputes that it was mustard gas. Their view was that it was basically fuel for the Scud missiles.
Yes, sir. Their back was that it was red fuming nitric acid, which is a rocket propellant or oxidizer.
And what's your reaction to that?
I don't believe it, because at that day, during that day, we had reconnaissance vehicles, a calibrated mobile mass spectrometer, which is the nerve center for that FOX to detect chemical agents, that was calibrated the day before by General Dynamics. The soldiers are trained to do their pre-calibration of the system.
Would you be able to tell the difference between the Scud fuel and equipment?
After investigations by Senator Riegel's staff and his professional staff aides, they submitted questions to the Institute of Technology on the ability of a mobile mass spectrometer to detect or identify red nitric acid. Based on their comments back, it was that it's virtually impossible red fuming nitric acid, because the mass spectrometer would be destroyed in the process. The membranes within would be destroyed. I didn't know that at that time, but when I was on the ground, I knew for a fact that systems were working. There was no doubt in my mind that our equipment, you know, functioned properly and that we detected properly those chemical warfare agents.
So your testimony is that you would acknowledge that the Chemical and Biological Defense Establishment disputes your finding, but you take issue with their finding and don't accept their.
Yes, sir. And there's a couple reasons why, in addition to the mass spectrometer reports. The British laboratory identified that the soldier, his suit was removed from the area and transported back to the UK for analysis. As members from the Office of Chemical and Biological Management contacted me to dispute my report, they stated to me that suit was moved out of the area. And I said, well, that's impossible, because I observed the suit being burned there on site, because the commander in charge at that time, the British commander, stated that anybody that went past what we call the contaminated hot zone line, if you were in the hot zone line, if once you came out of it, you're decontaminated, and then you would have it centrally located. The individual would move it to an area, a depression in the area, for a controlled burn. And I, with my own eyes, looked at the equipment, because not only did the British put equipment into that area, but I had a soldier who was assisting the British decon team who actually had his suit and put into that burn site, and we observed the suit being burned. I also was informed that on investigations at that site had happened, and it was possible or likely picked up some of the residue in that burn site, but I just don't believe that.
Yeah, yes.
Jim, can I just briefly pick up on this point? Presumably, we are spending many millions of dollars on this and other equipment, which is designed to pick up chemical and biological agents, correct?
Yes, sir.
And what we are hearing is that presumably of an agent, it was discarded because all of the machinery in every single instance was faulty.
Sir, I would only say that on the day of our detection, every senior officer, senior person on the ground did not dispute our findings. They acknowledged
on the ground.
On the ground that evidence of a functioning mass spectrometer that were produced from that, and the incident or the accident with the British soldier, that yes, in fact, it was a chemical.
But as the chairman has indicated, the higher up you went, these disclosures and this information was discarded. Chairman, that by definition, every single instance of an alarm going off or detection from the Vox vehicles at the top was suggested that there was faulty equipment. What is the explanation officially given as to how come all of this equipment, which presumably cost us millions of dollars, which was designed to protect your lives and your comrades' lives, what is the official line being given as to how come all of this equipment is faulty, and have we thrown it all out? Or have we gone back to the manufacturers and demanded our money back, so to speak? All of this equipment was faulty. Does anyone have a thought on that?
Sir, speaking from my point of view, sir, the Fox vehicles that were, when I arrived in Saudi Arabia, the Marines did not know what a Fox vehicle was. So because of, and neither did the commanders. So because of that, around and I showed and demonstrated what the capabilities and the mission of the Fox. As I was doing that, because it was such a strange looking vehicle to the Marines, I had tanks and machine gunners and Amtraks, Cobras that were part of our air when I wanted to blow up my Fox vehicle. So when I passed information at Jabber Airfield about the sulfur up the chain of command, the Marines and the sailors in the immediate area donned their field protective mask and went into full MOP level 4. I think because when we were passing it up the chain of command, one thing they told me to do, to run a mass spectrometer, which meant they didn't know what they were talking about because the equipment on the Fox vehicle is a mass spectrometer, and they told me to run one. So they knew what the Fox vehicle was about because they had a demonstration, but they weren't fully aware of what the capabilities of the Fox vehicles were at that time.
If I could, Mr. Fatah, I know you have to leave soon, and I'd like to make sure that you get to ask questions again.
Yeah, I wanted to follow up on Sergeant Carras's comment. I thought, and I was going to go back through it, but you mentioned that at some point you came along an ammunition bunker or a warehouse, and that there were what appeared to be drums containing chemical agents. Is that correct? Did you say that?
No, sir.
Did you say that you found drums that had skull and the X to it?
The city was known as the Armored Corps ASP. In an area that was far off the road, in order to get to this area, I had to go over a large hill past this big group of trees into an area that was built up bermed. Next to the area was 1st Battalion, 5th Marines. They were set up about 100 yards away from this area. Also in this area, there was a Winnebago type vehicle that was pretty fancy looking. It was dug into the ground. It was concreted with cinder blocks up around it. There, within that same office, there was leather couches, crystal, pictures of Saddam Hussein, all within this area right here. And it was obvious that this was a manned area. About 100 yards or 50 yards away from this right here was larger berms. Once we went inside this ammunition storage area, the metal drums that were in the area were there just as if an ammunition storage area here in the United States, you have different placarding to let you know what the different style kind of ammunition that's stored in there. So there's a good probability that the green fire extinguisher or the olive drab 55-gallon drum or whatever were probably empty. They were just there because there was no way that they could use in order to placard the area to let somebody else know that was familiar with that placarding procedures on what kind of ammunition was in there.
Okay, so there were normal non-chemical ammunition.
Yes, sir.
That was American-made.
In those 55-gallon drums.
Okay.
They were open and bung-top drums that were painted.
I understand. When you mentioned that they were American-made ammunition.
Sir, within that, also, there was 155 rounds that were sitting on top of a box, on the boxes. Spectrum of sulfur mustard on there that had yellow taping with skull and crossbones on it. They had little signs next to them with a little skull and crossbone next to it. And exact ammo box that we would use in the United States that had this DODIC, the NSN, everything else like that. And we were getting a spectrum of sulfur right there was from the United States. Further along inside this chemical weapon area, I detected the HT mustard, which is a derivative of the sulfur mustard, and that had boxes. All the ammunition within that chemical weapon storage area was from Holland, Jordan, and the United States.
Okay. Now, the last thing I want to say, and I want to thank the chairman for yielding to me, is I want
as much time as you want.
Okay. Well, then, is that it's obvious the issues here is that during the Iran-Iraq conflict, we supplied items to some of these ammunitions to Iraq, which is problematic, to say the least. Now, Major Johnson?
Yes, sir.
You are an active duty officer in the service. I really want to take a minute and you and Sergeant Grass and the Major for appearing, because it's obvious, given the testimony, that it conflicts with everything that we've heard from official, from the CIA, from the Department of Defense, from, people who are much higher up in the chain of command. And it's my hope that from your testimony here today, it will elicit more candid responses from the Department of Defense and others as we go forward. I hope, and I know the chairman agrees, that this should not in any way impair any of your efforts as you move up in the Department of Defense. I know that there should not be concern about that. I want to commend you for coming forward. And I do think that your testimony, all of it, raises a lot of issues for us to deal with as we go forward, and not the least of which is this fact of American-made ammunition getting into the hands of people who we then find ourselves having a conflict with. So I want to thank the chairman for the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank the gentleman. When I was elected in 1987, one of the first that I had was a briefing about chemical and nuclear potential in the Middle East. And the bottom line to my briefing was that there wasn't hardly anyone in Congress who didn't know that both, obviously, the Iraqis and Iranians had chemicals, and that some other countries did as well. We knew the before the war proceeded, we obviously knew that there were chemical weapons that we knew Iran and Iraq had obviously both used them. And I will say parenthetically that I got on bended knee. I remember when the Israelis bombed the nuclear plant in Iraq, I was shocked at the time. I was later until I had my first briefing, and I mentally got down on my hands and knees in gratitude for the Israelis for bombing that plant. Having said that, sir, I wasn't intending, Sergeant Grass, to get into this issue, but because you have mentioned it, it may be a factor in this whole reason of why we're not hearing things as quickly as we want. There was U.S. made. We're not talking about something that would project a missile. We're also, or a shell. We're talking about chemical, the actual chemical agents that were U.S.
That's correct.
Was there any concern on the part of your superiors that that was the case? I mean, was this basically taken from you? Well, I don't want to put words in your mouth. Tell me a little bit more about the reaction of your superiors when you knew and they knew that some of the weapons were actually U.S. made and some of the chemical agents were U.S. made, in your judgment.
Sir, before I took off to that area, Chief Warrant Officer Cottrell had told me that if I found chemicals out there, finding some honey, that way I wasn't going to alert the entire task force unnecessarily.
What does that mean? Just
that meant that because of proper when you detect a chemical, you use rated procedures, flash, flash, flash.
But let me just ask you, we're talking about, in a sense, dormant chemicals versus chemicals that have been put into use to stop the enemy. What you uncovered here was a chemical storage, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. That wasn't potentially a threat to anyone in that condition.
At the time, yes, sir.
Yes,
although
okay.
1st Battalion, 5th Marines was right outside that area.
Right. But they were not in the hands of the Iraqis, these chemicals, these shells and so on. These were under our control by the time you saw them.
Yes, sir, that's correct.
Okay. So you went there, and what were your orders?
That if I did find any chemical weapons around there, I was to call back and let Chief Warrant Officer Cottrell know that we had found some honey.
And you called it honey?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
We had mentioned that we had some honey. After I had got the three different chemicals, the sulfur mustard, HD mustard, and the benzyl bromide, I went back to Chief Warrant Officer Cottrell. Before I left, I wrote down information in my little book here on the different drums and the fire extinguishers, and I got a visual picture on the way that this chemical weapon storage area was made, being a former ammunition technician. When I got back, I had gotten out of the Fox vehicle. Chief Warrant Officer Cottrell and the commanding officer of Task Force Ripper and several other officers, including the intel officers, went inside there. I gave them great detail on what we saw out there, including the ammunition from Jordan, Holland, and the United States.
Before continuing that part, when you went to the site, you got out of your Fox vehicle to make visual verification, or were you in the Fox vehicle the whole time?
We didn't get out of the Fox vehicle for any reason, sir.
Okay, now, maybe I don't need to explain this, but the disadvantage of being asked by civilians is we don't know certain things, and the advantage is we don't know certain things, and the bottom line is we learn through this process. So I'm asking ignorant questions to you, but it's helpful to us, the committee, and ultimately how we report our findings. What I'm not clear about is if it was in a dormant state, why wouldn't you get out of a Fox vehicle?
We had, there were thousands of ammo bunkers in the 3rd Armored Corps ASP, or ammunition storage supply area. And we drove monitoring for any vapor contamination because there were just so many. Unless it was a suspicious liquid on the ground, that's when I checked that suspicious liquid for liquid contamination.
So
because of the ability of the mass spectrometer, there's no reason why one of the crew members of the Fox vehicle has to get outside of the Fox in order to take any kind of reading.
And it's your training, correct? I mean, you're told not to for various reasons.
Absolutely, sir. If I have a, if my mass spectrometers tell me there's a chemical out in the air, then I'm definitely not going to get out of that vehicle.
But what I'm trying to nail down is it's out in the area, but it's dormant. It's not, it's in containers, it's not, or is some of it out?
It could have possibly been a leaking weapon, sir.
Okay. For all you know, we could have had our soldiers who could have gone into that position after you left without any of the knowledge that you had, correct?
That's correct, sir. Even back at Jabber Airfield, 3rd Tank Battalion was surrounding me as I got that sulfur mustard reading. And I know that after we had taken Jabber Airfield and continued onward toward Kuwait City, the other units and elements of 1st or 2nd Marine Division went through Jabber Airfield.
So your expertise tells you to stay in the Fox vehicle.
Yes,
sir. You leave, you get out of the Fox vehicle, you're back at your destination, but you have no way to verify whether that was cordoned off and that our soldiers were warned not to go in that area.
Before I went back to Task Force Ripper's Maine to see Chief Warrant Officer Cottrell, I went over to 1st Battalion, 5th Marines, talked to the NBC officer, Chief Warrant Officer Fletcher, and the commanding officer of 1st Battalion, 5th Marines, and told them that I just found chemical weapons over there, and I told them to stay out of that area. Because basically, nobody had gone into that area. We were the first ones to go into the area. And the Winnebago that was dug under the ground was like a tourist area.
Yeah.
So there's a good possibility.
But you can't confirm whether or not your warning was heeded. You did your job, officer. Sergeant. But I don't know how it was treated by anyone else.
I'm sure that the commanding officer of 1-5 had passed it down his chain of command, and I'm sure that they stayed out of that chemical
weapons. One of the things I'm not too impressed with is the chain of command. When I'm hearing that, I'm losing faith, with all due respect. I mean, you did your job, but who knows what he said, who knows what was said to the next person in line. Now, you got back, you got out of the Fox vehicle, and?
Myself and Chief Warrant Officer Cottrell and Colonel Fulford, who was the commanding officer of Task Force Ripper, an executive officer and several other officers, went into a tent. Inside that tent, I had the 3 mass spectrometer printout tickets from the chemical weapons storage area I had just left. I also had the printout from back at Jabber Airfield from the sulfur mustard back there. I showed them the similarities between both sulfur mustard tickets. I also explained to them in great detail about the chemical weapons storage area. And they determined that division, which was located at the Kuwait International Airport, must be notified, 1st Marine Division. So one of the officers had called over there, and they made it so I was going to escort an EO, an explosive ordnance, to that chemical weapon storage area the next day. So at that point right there, the chain of command was acknowledging that there was a possible chemical weapon storage over there, and that the readings from the storage area and Jabber Airfield were positive, and they wanted to find out exactly what was going on.
Okay. Major Airbear, is it your testimony, or I'm forgetting now, whose testimony of concern about shells containing chemical agents and mines containing chemical agents? That was your testimony.
Yes.
Okay. What, again, was the reason why you believed that one or two of the mines had actual chemical agents? What made you believe that? Was it what you were told? Was it something that alarm system that you had? Tell me again how you felt there was a chemical agent.
I was told.
By his battalion 3.
That
a chemical mine had gone off.
And
he learned later. That the Fox vehicle confirmed positive nerve agents Sarin. And also Lewisite Muster.
Okay, I'm going to have you stop here a second. Major Johnson and Sergeant Grass, would you respond to what we were just told by the Major? Tell me your reaction to that.
The Fox News commander for 6th Marines is Master Sergeant Bradford, located 2nd Marine Division at NBC at Camp Lejeune. He was never called in order to give his testimony on this, although I gave that information to the advisory committee in May.
The advisory committee being?
Lieutenant Colonel Knowles?
No, the advisory committee of?
The Presidential Advisory Committee on the Persian Gulf Illness in May, sir. And as I stated before, Master Sergeant Bradford has not been contacted.
He's been contacted now. You said he's now been contacted.
As of Friday, he has not been contacted.
Well, has not been.
That's correct, sir.
For the record, he has not yet been contacted.
Yes, sir.
Forget the advisory committee commission to start with. What I'm having a hard time reconciling is why a few months later, certainly within a year, all the people involved wouldn't have been interviewed. That's what I'm having a hard time understanding. How many times have you been interviewed by your superior officers without you proactively asking to be?
I've always let my chain of command know at every unit I've been with.
Okay. So when you go to another unit, you still say the same story?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that's my definition of someone crying in the wilderness. No one has proactively sat down, talked with you, questioned you, compared your records, and so on?
No, sir, they have not.
Major Johnson, what's your reaction to...
I have never been contacted by anyone in the chain of command regarding my report of my findings. But when I presented my report, apparently that was 3 years after...
When you say you presented it to...
Presented it to my supervisors,
right,
to modify some instruction, it seemed to not be an issue to anyone. No one really gave it much weight. They just said, go ahead and go do great and wonderful things with teaching. But when it got into the hands or into the realm of members up here in Washington who were interested in it, then the interest increased. Then the matter of disputing my findings jumped to what I call an all-time high. 3 years had went by. I left the desert, the Persian Gulf, with the fact in my mind that we were successful in our findings, questioned the chain of command or asked the chain of command that I was assigned to if they had heard anything. Nothing ever came of it. So I left there thinking that we had done the right thing. And it did not become an issue until 3 years after the fact, after it was found out that my report was of interest to someone outside of Department of the Army, Department of Defense.
See, I'm haunted by the CIA telling me in a matter-of-fact way that they never communicated with any of our officers, our own people. It would seem to me we'd get information from our own people before we'd go somewhere else. Now, they may be able to say that's not their jurisdiction, but it just, to me, was a warning sign to me that this is just extraordinarily pervasive. I want you to respond to what Major Hebert said, talking about the mines, talking about the shells. Major Hebert, you were saying you saw the shells explode and a plume of smoke, but you didn't see what would be viewed as an explosion.
Yes, sir, that's correct.
Okay, so you actually you saw this. This isn't some report. This is something you witnessed.
During the actual breaching of the first minefield.
And the second explosion.
He saw and heard the first explosion. And the second one, he only heard the explosion.
But the first one, you basically saw it more as a plume of smoke than what you would ordinarily view as a weapon designed to destroy.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I have no knowledge of how you clear a minefield. Is the process basically blowing up the mines? Do you just try to blow up the mines along the way, or do you just physically remove them?
Line charge. He has a device called a line charge. That is. Follows.
No.
Finds. That is fired across the minefield. And it's 1,750 pounds of explosions. Explosive.
So if in fact some of the mines were chemical instead of an explosive, you in effect would be basically blowing up the mines, and the mines would be unknown to you, would actually be causing the very harm they were intended to cause.
If they were chemical mines, sir, yes.
Okay. Now, we're almost done with this panel. Mr. Sanders is going to have some questions. I'm going to come back for a quick second, but Mr. Hebert, I'm going to give you an opportunity to make it just a short statement at the end, and so you might want to just think about what you want to say, and Mrs. Hebert as well. At the end, I'm going to give you an opportunity to make a statement. Instead of just being a scribe under order, both of you will be able to make a comment at the end. Major? Yes.
He wants you to know that he was with 2nd Marine Division. The gunny was with 1st Marine Division. They were operating within 2.5 to 3 miles within each other.
And on the 25th.
And on the 25th.
February.
Of February.
When they were having positive confirmation.
When they were having positive confirmations.
Of agents in the area.
Of agents in the area.
We were second combat engineer battalion.
You were second combat engineer battalion?
Yeah.
They were second combat engineer battalion.
We were not.
We were not
in MOP level 4.
They were not in MOP level 4.
For the entire day.
For the entire day.
For the 25th.
And that was February 25th.
Thank you for that information. Major, did you want to make a comment before I give the floor to Mr. Sanders?
No, sir.
Okay. Mr. Sanders?
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. As Mr. Fatah mentioned a little while ago, it was no secret that when you went over to the Persian Gulf, there was concern about the possibility of the use of chemical weapons. Everybody knew that, and presumably we were prepared to respond to that danger. Let me read you a quote from the front page of the New York Times, December 3rd, maybe get a comment. General Powell, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff at the time in 1991, said in an interview that while chemical detection alarms had sounded repeatedly during the war, American commanders in the Gulf had been unable to confirm the detections and had believed them to be false alarms. Another quote, December 5th, New York Times. The chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff during the war, General Powell, also now retired, said in an interview on Monday that chemical alarms sounded repeatedly during the war,
but that American commanders in the Gulf were unable to confirm them and consider them false alarms. Now, my question is this. If the military gave you rifles and the rifles did not fire or misfired, presumably people would be concerned and there would be a change of equipment, there would be a study, there would be a scandal, there would be an understanding, an attempt to understand what was going on. Sergeant Grass, is the Fox vehicle still being used, or based on the experiences of the Persian Gulf War, has it been discarded? Do you know if we've sued the manufacturer for producing an equipment which is just a faulty piece of equipment? Is it now recognized that the piece of equipment that you were utilizing is a piece of garbage? Is that now the conclusion that we've reached, or in fact, might we consider something else?
Sir, as I stated earlier, I'm a member of the Marine Corps Chemical Biological Incident Response Force, and we have two Fox vehicles assigned to us.
Still using them?
Yes, sir.
Well, if every time your piece of equipment, the vehicle, Fox vehicle, detected something, and if we also had other pieces of equipment that were giving us alarms during the war, and if the generals perceived that every single instance these were false positives, shouldn't we have done something with that equipment? Shouldn't we have said this is useless equipment? Or else that maybe the equipment was not false positive and that maybe we had a problem?
Sir, there's also been modifications to the Fox vehicle that with, I believe, a Rascal. I'm sure the Major might be able to
answer. You understand that. My point. One of two things. Either you have a faulty piece of equipment, and after the war, we want to find out why it's faulty, or else we have a piece of equipment which was functioning correctly, and we want to find out why that information was not transmitted to the public and to our soldiers. Major, do you want to...
Sir, from my last encounter with the Fox and the personnel that are training with it, we are still, in fact, using that system. We're still training soldiers at the United States Army Chemical
School. Using a piece of equipment that ostensibly during the war, its evidence and its information was not taken seriously. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, sir. We are, in fact, there have been several modifications to the vehicle. I cannot confirm if it's a result of activities in the Persian Gulf or during the Persian Gulf. I can assume all day long, but I know that one of the things that was mentioned to me was that my report and the disputes that were presented against it, they did in fact state in a document that the developer has gone back to relook the system, and that was the end of that. But we are still in fact using it. Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, one of the issues that I hope we will pursue is just that issue. Either you had faulty equipment, and clearly we should not be paying to continue to use that equipment, or else the equipment was working properly and there's something wrong when the information that that equipment gave us was not transmitted properly to the public and to our soldiers. The second question that I would ask Major Hebert, if I might, you're hurting now physically, and that's clear, and we very much appreciate your bravery and willingness to come here today. Do you know of people with whom you associated, people in your area during the war who are suffering illnesses that might be attributed to the conflict?
I know a few in my area.
Yes, sir, he knows a few in our area.
And similar problems to yours or just other kinds of?
Different kind of problems. Maybe rashes.
All different problems, mainly rashes.
Joint pains.
Those type of problems.
Okay. Did either of the other two gentlemen want to comment on that, Sergeant?
Yes, sir. In my case, as I stated before, my security, because we're such a strange-looking vehicle to the Marine Forces, they gave us tow vehicles, which are on the back of a Humvee. Several of my security, including the former Sergeant Randy Wheeler, are showing some of the same symptoms that Major Aber is. Other personnel within Task Force Ripper from 3rd Tanks are also suffering from some of the same symptoms some of the other Fox vehicles.
Same symptoms that Major Hebert is suffering from?
Yes, sir. Other elements within Task Force Ripper are also suffering from some of the same symptoms. They've either been discharged from the Marine Corps or are still remaining on active duty and trying their best to get medical assistance, especially the ones that have been discharged from the Marine Corps are trying to get medical assistance and just getting the runaround from the VA is doing it just like Randy Wheeler is. And there's others within 2nd Marine Division that are under the same kind of medical care and same illnesses and like that.
Thank
sir.
You. Major, did you want to?
Sir, this is a tough area for me because prior to deploying to the Gulf, I was in perfect health. After returning from the Gulf, I've begun to question my health, and I started documenting it back in 93. And there's several things that I'm concerned about. Changes, for example, in my blood pressure, having to fight constantly to control the blood pressure, headaches, burning eyes, joint pain, having an arthroscope done on my left knee to remove a growth that has been left to the doctors as a mystery as to why it was there. Have not had any knee injuries since high school football, and this growth is there. Chest pains, off and on. Just was released out of the hospital on the 26th of September. After being diagnosed with gastrointestinal bleeding, or basically I had 3 bleeding ulcers that were repaired. And every day it's a constant fight with me to say to myself, is it a result from the Gulf? It's hard for me to say because I keep saying to myself, well, maybe I wasn't there long enough, but what is long enough? One day, 180 days, or what? I don't know. But since that time, I've experienced changes in my health. I don't know if it's due to the fact of the normal process of aging in the body or if it's an advanced aging process or whatnot in the body. But each day it gives me a concern that comes back to activity in the Persian Gulf.
Yes.
Am I?
In Randy's testimony?
I mentioned so.
Ailments. In his testimony, he mentioned several different ailments. Most of which he has observed. From members of all branches of the service.
Within the Marines, there was operated with the Sergeant Vice.
Also from one of the Marines that were operating with Gunny Sergeant
Vice.
Grass, I'm sorry.
He is an ordnance officer.
He's an ordnance officer. He was with Gunny Sergeant Grass.
And several members of his unit.
Several members from?
Seven.
7 members of his unit.
Were sent to Portsmouth.
Was sent to?
Portsmouth.
Portsmouth.
Naval Hospital.
Portsmouth Naval Hospital.
To be observed after the war.
To be observed after the war.
Only 2 of them.
Only 2 of them
are
now living.
Thanks very much, Major. My last question, and maybe nobody can answer it, is does the term aflatoxin mean anything to anybody up there?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Somebody want to comment on what we have heard about aflatoxin?
Sir, from what little I know about aflatoxin, is a carcinogen. It's a biological agent. Some individuals refer to it as black cancer. It's a process where once you're exposed, it could take months. It could take maybe a year or so before the effects on it really begins to take a toll on the body. There has not been much discussion from my understanding about alpha toxins, just that it's a biological agent, and that it was possible several months ago that the Iraqis had that capability in their biological arsenal.
Any other thoughts on that?
Randy has the same comment as Major Johnson. And he heard about that 3 days ago.
Okay. Thank you all very, very much.
We're almost done here, and I thank you all for your patience. Any of you or all of you undergo the DOD health exam for Gulf War veterans, the comprehensive clinical evaluation program called the CCEP? Major Johnson?
No, sir, I have not.
Sergeant Grass?
I was afforded the opportunity, if it's the same thing that you're talking about, sir, in 1993 when I was on Okinawa.
And you said chose not to take the opportunity, or?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And you have, okay. Thank you. When was that?
December 1995.
I'm going to ask this question, and you'll have to have your own good judgment on how you answer it, but you're all soldiers, and you don't necessarily volunteer information. You make yourself available, and we have to have the good sense to ask the right questions. My fear is that we haven't asked the right question. And if there's something you felt we should have asked, I would like you to ask yourself that question. Sergeant Grass, was there a question we should have asked you? And if there was, and you don't want to tell me what that question was, then I'll live with that, but I just need to know. Were there some questions we should have asked that we didn't?
One of the questions you didn't ask me was, were there any other chemical alarms within Task Force Ripper's area of operation that I was not called upon to verify or check? And the answer to that question is, yes, there were other areas within Task Force Ripper that had possible chemical exposure. It's just that I believe at the time they just chose not to call the Fox vehicle because whatever reason they chose.
So your response to that excellent question was that there were other potential exposures, and your Fox equipment was not called to verify.
That's correct. Also, the detector tickets were given to my chain of command, beginning with Chief Warrant Officer Cottrell, and I never saw those detector tickets again.
We're going to try to track that down, but I need to be clear, as you touched a point, there's a printout and a tape. They are two different things. The equipment gives a printout. It also gives you a tape. Are those two different items?
It's on the same ticket.
Okay. Thank you. Major Johnson, was there a question we should have asked or questions we should have asked that you would like to ask yourself?
Sir, I agree with the gunnery sergeant. There's a question. Chain of custody of samples once they move from an area, the audit trail of where those agents go to, and an immediate response, meaning information back down, so individuals, team members, other soldiers know exactly what the bottom line was or is, what they found, not to wait years later to say, Here's what the deal is about your equipment, which makes you wonder in your mind, makes you begin to speculate when you deal with people that I've dealt with in the Office of Chemical and Biological Matters on my competence in the ability to use that equipment. Because I, for 3 years at the time of the report, knew in my heart and my mind that the equipment worked, soldiers worked well, did well, and then to come back later and tell you you didn't know what you were doing. It's hard for me to really grab that, because I know that at that time, with functioning equipment and properly trained soldiers, those soldiers did their job. And I think that that's, to me, that's a letdown. And I think, and that leads into the confidence in our equipment. It, you know, it works. If it does not work, we have to be able to present information immediately to say that it does not work and find a way to improve it so that we protect our soldiers. We do the mission, and we protect the force. And that was important to me. If there's a question, it's custody and confidence in the equipment.
Thank you. I'm going to invite each of you to just make a closing statement, if you did, by your question. Pardon me? Oh, Mr. Abar, sorry. What question, is there a question that we should have asked you, or questions?
Do you feel that the United States exported
chemicals?
Precursors.
Mr. Abar, did you get the sense of that question? Do you want to tell us what his question was?
Did you get that?
Mr. Abar?
Precursors. Yes, the word was precursors.
To Iraq. Prior to the war. The answer to that question, based on from the hearing back in May and October
of 94,
yes, there were.
It's an American soldier who fought in the Persian Gulf. You would have wanted me to, and who's now suffering, you would have wanted me to ask the question, did you think the United States exported chemicals to the Persian Gulf? And your answer is?
Chemical precursors.
Prior to the war. What?
Chemical precursors.
To make the chemical weapon.
You're right. The components to make the chemical weapons. And your response to that question would be?
Yes, they did, based on the hearing that you held back in May and October of 94.
That was the Regal Committee in the Senate. Well, I'm going to just invite each of you, and that includes your father and your dear wife. But Mr. Major Johnson, is there any last point you want to make before we conduct this, end this panel?
So the only point I would make in conclusion is that the facts that I presented on today regarding the 7th and the 8th, I believe strongly by those facts, those activities that occurred during that day. And I stand behind what I said. Even though there have been disputes, I still stand to say that our equipment was functioning. We properly detected chemical warfare agents, which to me confirmed that they were present in the region or in the theater of operation, in this case Kuwait, and that I observed firsthand a coalition soldier, a British soldier, come in contact with it on the 8th of August, which in my mind confirms for me that a soldier was exposed to a toxic chemical warfare agent.
Thank you. Sergeant Grass?
Sir, I just want to say that there are many Marine Corps NBC defense specialists that detected chemicals in their area of operation, not just myself with my Fox vehicle. The other Fox vehicle commanders, not just they detected chemicals, but some of the Marines that were within 1st and 2nd Marine Divisions also detected chemicals. The chemical exposure is obviously not just within Task Force Ripper's area or 6th Marine Regiment's area. It's also within elements of the 1st and 2nd Marine Division. And I know some of these individuals have information, although there's really no solid proof as a piece of paper, as a printout from the mass spectrometer, or a coffee can full of liquid chemical agents, or something to that sort to prove it. But I think the proof goes with the number of personnel that have died, or the personnel that have that are seriously ill from the effects of the Gulf War. Myself, I've got little rashes on my ankle and another part of my body. My wife's been diagnosed with multiple sclerosis here within the last couple months. And there are just numerous other cases of illnesses that people have from something that went on over there, whether that was the exposure of chemical weapons or biological weapons or both. And I just want to thank the committee for taking this time and pursuing this in a positive manner. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. You have done your son honor by joining him in this very important, his very important testimony. We really appreciate you sharing this experience with your son and be happy to hear from you.
I appreciate the, okay. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. On behalf of my wife, Sherdell, and I, we appreciate the opportunity to be here with Randy and Kim. It's, to me, it's quite obvious the facts speak for themselves. We have soldiers, men and women, who fought in Desert Storm, Desert Shield, with all kinds of ailments. And it appears that nothing or very little is being done to help them. It is time to stop this search for someone necessarily put the blame and focus our efforts on what we need to do to help these young men and women who so bravely fought for us. We have in the past brought our resources together to build the atom bomb, to do all kinds of things. Certainly we can cooperate together and bring our resources together to focus on ways of helping them, not only them, but the people of the United States. We are all exposed to Desert Storm. We are all exposed. Our experience with our son Randy is one in which he came home appearing healthy, and only in the last several years has it been that his symptoms have progressed very rapidly. Exposures to chemicals and other agents in our atmosphere, on our grounds, the chemicals that we're putting within our environment, these have caused, in my opinion, have caused his situation, his symptoms to move more rapidly. We need to get the experts. We don't need those people who do not have the facts making the decisions at this point in time. We need people with the facts coming together to discuss them in an open way without any questions about who's right, who's wrong, but to protect our boys and our women and ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mrs. Hebert, would you like to make a comment? Then I'll ask your husband to make a comment. Thank you for appearing with him, and thank you for helping to make it easier for us to communicate with each other. Mrs. Hebert, would you like to make a comment?
I just want to thank you for the opportunity to appear before you. I just am speaking for all spouses all over the country. of our frustrations, watching our husbands go to war, fight for their country, willing to die for our country. And still today, if my husband was healthy and was it was if it was laid before him that he would come home in this condition, I can guarantee my husband would still go to war. Knowing this of how brave my husband is and that he fought for his country, and so many other military wives are standing behind their husbands going through the same situation that I am with children, we are just stressed out. We are just crying out for the government to do something for these brave men. And I hope today that some good will come out of this hearing, and I hope that all the men that are suffering from illnesses, even if it's rashes or to the extremists such as my husband, for the government to please do not forget these men and do something and take action immediately. Thank you.
Thank you. Major Abar, you have done your country proud in service then and your service now, as has both Major Johnson and Sergeant Grass, and I would like you to end this part of the panel and any comment you'd like to make.
Myself, Major Johnson, and Gunnery Sergeant Grass. All took an oath when we came into the military to support the Constitution of the United States against our enemies, all enemies. Both foreign and domestic. And some of our enemies are within our own government.
Unfortunately.
Thank you.
For your effort.
Thank you for your effort.
So continue.
To continue
to find,
the source, the truth,
also, the best source of military intelligence.
The best source of military intelligence
is
the individual
Marine,
Air Force,
soldier.
Airmen
and Navy.
And Navy.
Personnel.
That were on the ground.
And these
men right here
were
on the ground.
And
they know
the
truth.
Also. It would be beneficial.
It will be beneficial.
It
would be beneficial.
If the committee.
The committee.
Would pursue.
Higher level officers.
In
the Marine Corps.
For their.
Opinion. Only less than one month ago,
his commandant said he believes
chemical weapons were used.
And if he said they were used,
and if he feels they were used,
He's supporting the statement of the first vehicle commanders.
He's supporting the statement of the Fox vehicle commanders.
In my opinion.
In Randy's opinion.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
God bless you. We're going to have a 5-minute recess. We need to call this hearing to order and call our last panel. Our last panelist is Patrick Eddington. He's the former CIA analyst. And Mr. Eddington, if you would stay standing, I'll swear you in. You would raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you will give before this subcommittee will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you. You may be seated. I'm sorry. And we'll note for the record that the witnesses responded in the affirmative. We welcome your testimony and thank you for your patience. Our first panel was a little longer than we may have expected, but it's great to have you here and thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and obviously it was compelling testimony. I think we would all agree. I have a brief oral statement. Mr. Chairman, Acting Ranking Member Sanders, members of the committee, I appreciate the opportunity to appear before you today to discuss an issue that affects both the national security of our nation and the health of tens of thousands of Desert Storm veterans, chemical agent exposures during the Persian Gulf War. For the record, my written statement details the attempts of myself and my wife to raise this issue within the Central Intelligence Agency over an approximately 1-year period. I do not feel the need at this time to go into any additional detail on that statement. I will obviously be happy to answer any questions regarding that statement. Additionally, today I'm prepared to discuss any issues related to potential chemical agent exposures during Operation Desert Storm. However, in addition to my written statement, I have one further disclosure and comment that I would like to offer. Recently, a medically retired U.S. Army nuclear, biological, and chemical non-commissioned officer contacted me regarding his possible exposure to chemical agents. Like many Gulf War veterans, this soldier claimed to have logs showing chemical agent alarms going off and unit personnel being exposed to chemical nerve agents from leaking chemical munitions. The difference in this case was that neither the soldier nor his unit were deployed to the Persian Gulf. Sergeant First Class Michael Morrissey had been an NBC NCO assigned to the 330th Ordnance Company of the 59th Ordnance Brigade.
I'm going to just interrupt you a second. I'm getting a feedback, and I don't know if it's the mics that we have that are on that need to be turned off, so just your mic is on. Anybody have a suggestion here?
How about a sound check?
Pardon me? You can speak loudly. Yeah, let's turn those mics off. Tom, please. Thank you. We're not talking about the C-SPAN mics. We're talking about the main. Yeah, if you could turn them off. I think they have a switch on the top side there. Yeah. Let's see. Would that make a difference? Let's give it a try. Thank you. Thank you.
Sergeant First Class Michael Morrissey had been an NBC NCO assigned to the 330th Ordnance Company of the 59th Ordnance Brigade located near Klausen, Germany. Between July and October of 1990, Morrissey's unit was involved in Operation Steel Box, the removal of more than 170,000 aging chemical weapons, nerve agent munitions from an American chemical weapons depot in Germany. On November 23, 1996, my wife and I flew to Seattle to hear Sergeant Morrissey's story. Quote, I would have done this earlier, he told us, but I'm just now recovering from my bone marrow transplant at the Seattle VA hospital. Morrissey had developed CML leukemia in May of 1995. That particular form of leukemia is caused, according to Sergeant Morrissey, by exposure to ionizing radiation or toxic chemicals such as nerve agents. Sergeant Morrissey kept all the unit logs from the Operation Steel Box period, even though the officer in charge had ordered him to destroy them. Morrissey informed me that his unit had to report any chemical incidents, accidents, or leaks up the chain of command, according to Sergeant Morrissey. This form of reporting requirement was congressionally mandated. Morrissey indicated that all the reports sent up the chain stated that there had been no chemical incidents. Morrissey stated that the reports were deliberately falsified. In my presence, Morrissey pulled out a log entry for July 10, 1990, showing that an M8 alarm had gone off at one of the chemical storage bunkers. There were no other contaminants in the area, and the device was fully functional and working normally. Additional detection equipment was dispatched to the bunker, and according to the log extract, the air sample readings appeared to indicate a slight trace of nerve agent in the air. Quote, "I was told to overlook such incidents," Morrissey noted, end quote. The 10 weeks of logs that Morrissey retained appeared to have several such incidents, to include some personnel who displayed pinpointed pupils and other telltale signs of nerve agent exposure. Within a year of leaving the unit, Morrissey began to experience periodic paralysis in his extremities. He also began having memory problems. Quote, "I used to be able to quote you chapter and verse from any NBC manual," he told me. "Now I sometimes can't remember what I did yesterday or even 5 minutes ago," end quote. What upset Morrissey the most was that his chain of command clearly understood the potential risks. Quote, "They've said they didn't know about possible effects of low-level chemical exposure," he said, referring to the Department of Defense. "If that's true, why did everyone in my unit have to sign this?" Morrissey handed me a document previously classified secret and entitled General Information, Nerve Agent Intoxication and Treatment. Two paragraphs immediately caught my attention. Signs and symptoms of chronic low-dose exposure: memory loss, decreased alertness, decreased problem-solving ability, and language problems are suspected, but have not been proven by scientific study. Teratogenicity, ability to cause birth defects. Although some organophosphate pesticides have been shown to be teratogenic in animals.
Mr. Eddington?
Yes.
I think this is important what you're saying. I just need to get a perspective. This is not your testimony yet. I mean, is this,
if I can continue, Mr. Chairman, I think you'll see.
I like to put things in boxes. I need to know where I was and where I'm headed. What are you sharing with us now? What is the motivation of what you're sharing with us now?
The information that this NBC NCO provided to me, I believe, has a direct bearing on the health issues that are affecting.
No, it does. It does. Now, but you're here as a former CIA agent, and so you are not yet into your own official testimony. Is that correct?
I have simply submitted my written statement for the record. I wanted to ensure that this information from this particular soldier.
No. I know that. You're the only witness, and I'll stay here as long as it takes. So, if you have any concern about, you're not being able to share something, don't be concerned.
No, that's okay. Not my concern at all.
I just want you to wrap this part up, and we'll come back to it. I want to make sure we have a specific reason for having you here.
I understand
I want to make sure that you specifically address your expertise as a CIA agent and what your concern is. And then we'll come back in more detail with this. But see, I wasn't with you in the beginning, so I'm not with you now. And following
I believe when I complete the next page, okay. You'll have a very clear understanding.
Okay.
As I indicated, this document indicated that there were problems with regards to organophosphate pesticides showing birth defect possibilities in animals. This Department of Defense document states that these effects have not been shown in carefully controlled experiments using nerve agents. The last sentence of this paragraph was misleading. To the best of my knowledge, the Department of Defense has never conducted carefully controlled experiments with nerve agents to determine their possible implications for birth defects. Despite this, DOD suspected that chronic low-level nerve agent exposure could produce serious chronic health problems in exposed personnel a year before the coalition bombing campaign would result in the release of tons of such toxic agents over American forces in Saudi Arabia. Every member of Morrissey's unit was required to sign an identical document. The fact that DOD classified this information sheet and the medical records of the entire 330th Ordnance Company secret is irrefutable evidence that DOD knew it was placing these men at risk and that it did not want the outside world to know about it. Mr. Chairman, Sergeant Morrissey's revelations obliterate DOD's claims that it had no concerns regarding the potential effects of low-level chemical agent exposures to American personnel working in close proximity to chemical agents. Clearly, this information bears directly on the issue of the health effects from similar exposures among Gulf War veterans. Gulf War veterans have testified before this and other committees regarding chemical agent detections in close proximity to Iraqi chemical munitions. In addition, United Nations inspectors have destroyed thousands of such leaking rounds in Iraq since 1991. But Sergeant Morrissey's revelations have broader implications. The specter of leaking chemical munitions at an American arsenal raised questions about potential chemical agent exposures among German civilians living near the depot, as well as potential exposures among our own citizens living near similar depots here in the continental United States. I urgently recommend that the Congress require the Department of Defense to immediately release all relevant unit logs and similar records maintained by every chemical weapons depot operated by the United States government to determine whether additional chemical agent releases or detections may have occurred at these facilities. Anything less would be a disservice not only to our veterans, but to the public at large. And that concludes my oral statement. I'll be happy to answer any questions you have about that statement or statement for the record.
You're here for a specific reason. What is your testimony before this committee?
My testimony before this committee is that we have a very serious problem with regards to low-level exposures among American forces. Okay. In addition to the entire issue of the Central Intelligence Agency and the Department of Defense failing to make information available to the American public with regards to this. Okay. Now, and that information is contained in detail in my written statement for the record.
Okay. The purpose of your having a written testimony is to help guide this committee. We want that testimony in some ways presented, whether you give it in full or in part, because we want, for the record, your testimony as it relates to your involvement as a CIA employee, analyst, and what your concern is about the CIA. And we'll be happy to touch on a whole host of other efforts, but we have a specific need to have that testimony, and you haven't yet shared that. So why don't you give us your testimony, the reason why I swore you in, the reason why you're here today. Then we'll cover anything else you'd like to.
If the chair would indulge me, I would be happy to read my entire statement.
No, I'd like you to summarize
it. In that case, Mr. Chairman, I will briefly summarize it.
Good. It doesn't even have to be briefly, if you could summarize it.
When I began the process of trying to raise this issue within the Central Intelligence Agency in July of 1994, from the time...
For the record, this issue being...
I'm sorry?
For the record, this issue being what?
Gulf War syndrome and the entire issue of potential chemical and biological agent exposures among American forces. When I began this process in July of 1994, it ultimately culminated in my leaving the Central Intelligence Agency in protest over their policy of refusing to deal honestly and openly with information that bore directly upon the health consequences of these veterans during their service.
How many years did you work in the CIA?
Almost nine.
So you were employed for 9 years, and was your work involved in this area that you ultimately resigned over?
I worked as a military analyst for almost 9 years at the CIA's National Photographic Interpretation Center.
Okay.
For the benefit of those who are not familiar with it, that particular organization was responsible for finding the Soviet missiles in Cuba in 1962. From February of 94 until... Pardon me, from May of 1994 until February of 1996, I worked in the CIA's Director of Intelligence, the Office of Scientific and Weapons Research, in an all-source analytical shop that was responsible for providing targeting support to military planners at the Pentagon. It was during that particular period of time, as a result of my wife's own tenure on the Senate Banking Committee, that I became aware of this entire issue of potential exposures among American forces during the Gulf War.
Now, your wife was or it was an employee of the CIA?
That is correct. She was an analyst with the Central Intelligence Agency.
For what period of time?
Just over 8 years.
Okay. And you met there, or were you married before?
That is correct. We met there.
Okay.
In the course of attempting to raise this issue, beginning in July of 94, we ran into a series of roadblocks, a great deal of resistance to our ideas, and in order to even get the Central Intelligence Agency to pay attention to what I had to say on this subject, I was forced to write a letter to the editor of the Washington Times in December 1994. After that letter was published, my superiors reluctantly agreed to hear what I had to say on the subject. And between January and March of 1995, I conducted a series of briefings within the Central Intelligence Agency at increasing levels of managerial responsibility, trying to get them to deal with this issue of chemical agent exposures and to get them to deal with the Department of Defense's lack of integrity in addressing this entire issue. My wife attended several of those briefings. The reaction was relatively uniform. It was one of hostility. It was one of, at times, contempt. It was a very difficult process, and essentially we got nowhere because we were giving them a message they simply did not want to hear, and that has continued to this day.
Okay. Now, what was your responsibility to the CIA that relates to the whole issue of the Gulf War illnesses?
During 1990 and 1991, I was part of a team at the National Photographic Interpretation Center who was responsible for monitoring Saddam Hussein's invasion of Kuwait, subsequent buildup, and the war itself. A few years after that, I was responsible for working Iraqi military forces, Iranian military forces, Persian Gulf military forces. And when I worked in OSWR, in the Director of Intelligence at CIA headquarters, I also had responsibilities dealing with contingency scenarios for attacks on Iraq and other Persian Gulf countries. So I have had a very long history of involvement in Persian Gulf security issues. As far as my direct involvement, the investigation that I initiated, I did on my own. I initiated that myself because the Central Intelligence Agency was not even looking at this issue until we brought it to their attention.
Okay, let me be, how do you know what they were looking at and not looking at? I'm unclear as to what would give you that scope of information
because,
and all that.
Because when my wife worked on Senator Riegel's staff beginning in February of 1994, she went over to CIA headquarters and made direct inquiries as to whether or not the Central Intelligence Agency and the specific components responsible for looking into these issues were in fact conducting an inquiry, and they were not. I made my own separate inquiries through my own channels and found out exactly the same thing. They
under law, what would have been the responsibility of the CIA as it relates to the Gulf War and our involvement as it relates to chemical information? What is their responsibility as you understand it?
Under the National Security Act of 1947, it is my understanding that the Central Intelligence Agency is to provide independent, unbiased advice to the President, the National Security Council, Congress, all policymaking organizations regarding potential threats to the United States and the national security. And the attitude that I took going into this was that if Saddam Hussein had used chemical or biological agents against our forces, and that had not been properly reported or dealt with during the war and after the war, the CIA had a responsibility to raise those particular issues and ensure that they were addressed.
Give me a second more. Is that right? This was not your direct area of expertise. Now, is it your testimony before the committee that the CIA didn't do any work, or the work they did was faulty, or?
There is absolutely no question that the Central Intelligence Agency made a concerted effort to exclude entire classes of information from its inquiry, and you have alluded to some of those. When Ms. Copeland testified before this committee in September, she admitted to you that the Central Intelligence Agency had not talked to a single veteran. That was one of the issues that I raised from day one, because the Central Intelligence Agency has had throughout its entire existence a specific component that is designed to do nothing but contact American citizens about their experiences overseas and their travels overseas. So for the Central Intelligence Agency to refuse to talk to American veterans about this issue is a complete departure from standard operating procedure.
Well, would it be a complete departure as it relates to talking to our own military? I mean, my view is they obviously should talk to any source that can give them information, and the best source is obviously the people who are there, our own military. But I was left with the impression that hearing that it is not, that basically they rely on DOD testimony and do not individually interview people in DOD.
Well,
is that their practice or just the practice in this case?
In my view, it was simply their practice in this case. And just a quick point on that. The CIA has consistently used DOD reporting and reporting from DOD sources in the course of putting together its estimates. To me, it seemed a politicization of intelligence to use that particular information coming from DOD in 1991, 1992, 1993, indicating that no chemical agents had been detected, And then when you get information 2 years later that, well, yes, they were detected in a widespread scale, now you're not going to talk to people who work for DOD, many of whom, like the witnesses we saw just a few moments ago, are still working for DOD. They have refused to talk to any of those folks.
Mr. Eddington, all day long, the issue that we've been focusing on, an issue of great concern, is the possibility that chemical agents, that our soldiers and other soldiers were exposed to chemical agents during the Persian Gulf War. Generally speaking, the speculation is that we exploded some munitions depots at Kamsia. There is some speculation that we may have bombed chemical factories in several locations and that the wind may have carried them over to our soldiers. Am I correct in assuming that you are adding a new dimension to this, that is your belief, in fact, that Saddam Hussein, in an offensive manner, actually used chemical weapons against our troops? Am I understanding you correctly on that?
Congressman Sanders, that is correct, and it is not simply my view. This committee was provided a report by Dr. Jonathan Tucker for the Center of Nonproliferation Studies at the Monterey Institute in California on January 29, 1996, in which he also makes the argument that the Iraqis employed these agents at least once against the Saudi port of Jubail on the 19th of January, 1991, and I endorse that.
Okay, so you, and that's an element, though, that as we are trying to understand what may have happened, there is, and reluctantly, the Pentagon has agreed that our soldiers were exposed to chemical weapons. They do not accept your thesis, though. Is that correct?
No, they continue to maintain that no attacks occurred.
Right.
That's correct.
Okay. But I just wanted to set that for the record.
Okay, if you want to continue with your testimony.
Very briefly, we attempted to raise this issue between January and March of 1995. As I indicated, we were unsuccessful. At the request of the former Senate Banking Senate Banking Committee investigator, James Toot, I gave a classified briefing to Senate Intelligence Committee staff on the 21st of March, 1995. I turned over roughly 100 documents to the Senate Intelligence Committee staff at that time. Those documents included specific references to attacks against American forces, and I outlined my evidence very, very briefly. The Secretary of Defense and the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs had told the Banking Committee in writing that no such information existed, and I produced 100 documents that basically said otherwise. Unfortunately,
was this the Banking Committee or the Intelligence Committee? You said the Intelligence Committee.
I gave a classified briefing, an approximate 10 to 15 minute classified briefing to the Senate Intelligence Committee on the 21st of March, 1995, and which I provided them with approximately 100 classified documents, almost all of which, by the way, originated with the Department of Defense. And I made just a very simple point. The Department of Defense claimed that this type of information on attacks and potential chemical agent exposures and even the presence of chemical munitions in Kuwait did not exist. And in my view, those documents proved exactly the opposite. Unfortunately, the Senate Intelligence Committee never followed up on that. And after that, the last opportunity we had to try to raise this within the executive branch was when Dr. Tucker was on the Presidential Advisory Committee. Dr. Tucker came to basically the same conclusions we did, but he ultimately left the advisory committee. And after that, we were simply marking time at the CIA. When I felt I had exhausted all of my avenues for trying to raise this issue within channels, I made the decision that it was time for me to leave the CIA.
You're here before the committee because you spoke out, and I told my committee I wanted you to come. I still don't have a handle on your testimony. I just have to be very frank with you because what I was hoping was that you would come before the committee and you would be very specific in terms of what you saw at the CIA that troubled you and not in general terms, but in some specific terms. Is there a part of your testimony you want to highlight orally?
Well, when I discussed just a few moments ago, Mr. Chairman, this notion of sitting down with CIA analysts trying to get them to deal with this issue, not only the analysts, but the managers were looking to exclude entire bodies.
Part of my problem is this issue. There are too many this issues. See, I mean, I could tell you 10 this issues. So what do you mean this issue?
The issue of chemical agent exposures among American forces.
Now, right. Now, it's your testimony that you gave before the Intelligence Committee documents that said that chemicals were used offensively.
That is correct.
Okay, and give me examples.
Mr. Chairman, I cannot, for security reasons, go into the specific details of those reports. I can tell you, however, that there are approximately 24 of them, that they originated with the National Security Agency, and that the House Intelligence Committee, I believe, counsel can correct me if I'm wrong, but the House Intelligence Committee and the House National Security Committee staff have the list of those specific documents because we have provided them with that. Okay. But on those specific circumstances, I would be violating my secrecy agreement
and
if I went into detail.
And it's your testimony that, as far as you're concerned, these documents clearly document that offensive weapons were, chemical weapons were used or might have been used, or, you know, how do you grade it?
There are specific examples of Iraqi units reporting using the weapons. There are other reports of, in some cases, American units being on the receiving end of such attacks. But again, it would be imprudent for me to go into much detail.
I accept that. Are they verified by detections, or were you not able to determine that?
This is a circumstance where we're dealing with some specific reports that were generated by the National Security Agency. I believe some of those can be correlated, in fact, with perhaps some of the testimony that was given here today. But because those reports are still specifically classified, I can't go into that. There are many other reports that have been declassified subsequently that I would be happy to discuss, such as the Iraqi ammunition storage area located at Ar-Rumaila in southeastern Iraq. This was an extremely large ammunition storage area, even larger than the Qamishia facility that has been in the news so much the last 6 months. And that specific facility had very, very specific signatures that indicated that it was a chemical storage facility. For example, chemical decontamination trenches located immediately outside the ammunition storage area itself. The delivery means for chemical weapons, in this case, Russian BM-21 multiple rocket launchers. There were additional security measures that were in place around this particular facility. That facility is significant because American forces, as you know, occupied southeastern Iraq and had orders to destroy all Iraqi captured ammunition in place. We have log entries from the 24th Infantry Division, which clearly show that chemical weapons were found in the Ar-Rumaila area. Two separate units, the 4th to 64th Armored, and I believe 2-7 Mechanized Infantry Battalion. That's only one site. There are, in my opinion, anywhere from a dozen to perhaps 36 different chemical weapons sites.
Clarify for me, is your point that this indicates the Iraqi intention to use offensive weapons, or is your concern that these depots were destroyed, then releasing, by our troops, releasing chemical agents?
I think it's a little bit of both. As Major Hebert testified just a while ago, there were some specific incidences that clearly occurred where weapons were fired at American forces that did not have a traditional high explosive reaction when they impacted.
Meaning that they might be chemical. Meaning
that they may well have been chemical. But I'm also very deeply concerned about the notion of the forward deployment of these chemical munitions all the way down to perhaps the battalion level, virtually the lowest level of the Iraqi army, with almost every single infantry and armored and mechanized unit that they had in the theater. There are several Iraqi prisoner of war reports that have been declassified and placed on the Gulf Link that deal with this specific issue. The Iraqi 20th Infantry Division, for example, there is a report from an Iraqi prisoner stating that his unit did in fact have chemical weapons, specifically mustard agent rounds. There are additional reports dealing with this whole issue of the massive deployment of these chemical weapons throughout the theater. There is a specific log entry, I believe it is contained in the records of the 18th Airborne Corps, that speaks to the issue of Saddam Hussein having given release authority for the use of chemical agents down to brigade level.
So the essence of what you're saying is, in your judgment, the problem is much more serious than we have been led to believe.
It is
not simply a question of the United States troops destroying chemical weapon bunkers, but that in fact there had been an offensive attack, and you regard it of some magnitude?
I think there are three exposure scenarios we're looking at, Mr. Sanders. The first occurs as a result of the Allied bombing campaign. Remember that Major Hebert made note of the fact in his testimony that the focus of the air campaign at the tactical and the operational level was to destroy not only the Iraqi delivery means for these weapons, but also the munitions that were located nearby as well. So when you take that into account, along with the destruction of the Iraqi chemical and biological weapons facilities in Iraq, you get, I think, a very massive potential exposure scenario there. So that's the first one. The second exposure scenario deals with the limited number of attacks that I believe occurred, and Dr. Tucker, as I've indicated, also believes this. Finally, we have the Comacia model, if you will, for the final set of exposures, the demolition taking place after the war.
Thank you.
You're saying offensive attacks for point two. And then you're saying again, one was defensive, the first was a bombing campaign, the second was the offensive use of weapons by Saddam Hussein's troops, and then the third is you're going back to defense, the bombing of Kamacia and maybe other sites.
That's correct.
Do you have any background that you can share with us on the Science Applications International Corporation's projections that the plumes during the war would go away from us, actually towards civilians in Iraq, but away from United States soldiers, and now that we're trying to resolve, in fact, whether SAIC actually was accurate in their projections?
I don't think that there's any question that there are some very serious problems with regards to the SAIC model. And one of the points that I would like to make is that it is my understanding that Ms. Slatkin informed committee staff, quote, the 1991 effort undertaken by DOD, since it was done before the war on bombing of facilities, was predictive modeling using a range of hypothetical parameters. In contrast, the recent CIA effort, which occurred after the war, was specific and modeled actual facilities, climatic data, et cetera, et cetera. In fact, in 1994, the Department of Defense provided the Senate Banking Committee with specific documentation on their modeling of potential fallout hazards at known or suspected Iraqi CW facilities that were attacked by coalition forces. So the reality is the SAIC contractor who was involved in this, Mr. Richard McNally, admitted to the Presidential Advisory Committee in April of 1996 that he was using real-time data during the war. So the CIA has misrepresented that aspect of this. This is not something new that's being done. Mr. McNally had access to all the real-time data. He used the real-time data originally. So in my view, that aspect of the model is completely invalid. There's another aspect of this model that is also invalid, and that is the CIA-SAIC emphasis on the attacks against these hardened concrete and steel-reinforced bunkers. We know from testimony from the UNSCOM inspectors, as well as some of the testimony we heard here today, that the Iraqis were storing these munitions in many times in areas that simply had open-topped earthen berms around their sides. That means that you're automatically going to get a great deal more in terms of collateral explosions, fallout, et cetera, than you would from a single bomb going in to a bunker and having some effluent come out from a small hole. So there are some very real problems with the SAIC CIA model.
At Kamacia, they described, we had witnesses who described the fact they were 2 miles away, and when they started blowing up the depot, that the missiles and shells were being projected out basically 12 miles from the site. Did you take a close look at that study? I mean, was that something that came across your desk?
Well, the actual... Are you referring to the original 1991 report?
Yes.
That was issued? That was one of the reports that we specifically gave to the Central Intelligence Agency analyst who was responsible for looking at this problem, and we provided him that documentation in February of 1995. So they were aware of it. It was in their possession. We had drawn to their attention, just as we drew the information regarding the Arumela site that I've discussed, all the other sites that I've been talking about for the last few minutes. We brought all of this to their attention. I had a stack, Mr. Chairman. It was in excess of 300 classified documents that dealt with a specific subject, where these munitions may have been located, what was known about their level of deployment, how far down they were deployed. We put all of this in the hands of the CIA's analyst in February of 1995.
Okay. Are you aware of any total destruction of material? Are you aware of fabricating in data? Are you aware of any of this effort? Is the CIA's major offense that they didn't do what they should have done, or what they actually took, in your judgment, they actually took information and doctored it?
I don't know that I would say that they doctored it. In the intelligence business, when we describe politicization of intelligence, it can take many forms. The form that I saw and the form that I can document is this notion of excluding entire classes of information that are normally included and evaluated in analyses.
Okay, in that context, tell me some exclusions.
Again, the complete refusal to contact Gulf War veterans. I was willing to put them in direct contact with veterans.
Okay, that's one.
They refused to look at the medical records of the individuals involved. They refused to look at the unit logs and try to correlate those with the known locations or suspected locations of chemical munitions.
Okay.
So you have this pattern that is established of trying to deliberately exclude entire classes of information. And if you would like, I can quote directly from the CIA document that was authored by Christopher Holmes in 1995 in response to our inquiry. The CIA does not plan a comprehensive review of DOD information such as troop testimony, medical records, or operational logs. That's being about as definitive as you can be in terms of deliberately excluding classes of information. Here's a problem I have with this. If the Central Intelligence Agency is willing to take the testimony of a gassed Iraqi Kurd or Shiite, and they're willing to use that in an analysis on an intelligence topic, why will they not use, why did they refuse to use testimony from our own citizens for exactly the same kind of analysis?
That's a great question. Did you ever put that to any of your coworkers?
Repeatedly. And the answer we received from management now, was that that's, quote, not intelligence information.
Okay.
And that's in complete contradiction to their normal policy of talking to people in DOD, debriefing folks that are in the military and other American citizens about their experiences and travels overseas.
What doesn't seem logical to me is it doesn't seem intelligent. You go to your best source, and then you're able to go to other sources, having gotten a good basis or foundation in which to then proceed to get more information. I'm very willing to go back to your first point until we cover this, but I want to make sure we've...
Yeah. May I just jump in?
Jump right in.
Okay. Obviously, the implication of what you're saying is very serious. In essence, you're suggesting that there is a major cover-up, that there's a lot of information out there that high-ranking officials in the CIA and, I gather, the DOD understood about the exposure of our troops to chemical agents. Could you speculate for us? Give us your reasoning as to, in fact, why this information was not made available.
This is one man's opinion.
One man's opinion, surely.
With that caveat, it is my view that the Department of Defense, this administration, and if it were still in power, the Bush administration, would not want to deal with this issue because it's going to cost a lot of money. Let's face it, if you got at least 250,000 sick vets, and that's my personal estimate.
You think literally half of the men and women over there?
I believe so, but based on their locations, because we have chemical agent detections, some of which you've indicated here in the map, which run all the way from north central Saudi Arabia all the way down to the Saudi port of Jubail, and these detections were taking place throughout the entire 6-week period of the war. You're talking about a massive exposure scenario. So there's the medical cost of dealing with it. But there are some other major issues that I think the Department of Defense doesn't want to have to acknowledge, and that is the very real vulnerability of our nuclear, biological, and chemical defense equipment. In the course of my research, I learned that the gas mask that most of our forces were wearing, the M17 series protective mask that I'm sure most of us have seen on television, have a failure rate of 26% to 40%.
But in fact, in the Persian Gulf, most of our men and women were not wearing these masks in the first place. Is that correct?
Unless an alarm had actually been sounded. But even then, my point here is they would have had even less protection.
Mm-hmm.
And the Department of Defense has known about that vulnerability and that problem for over a decade.
So you're suggesting that the second reason, in addition to the potentially huge financial expenses, is to tell us to not want to reveal that if we send people to war, they're really vulnerable.
That's exactly correct. And I think a third reason that was touched on in the earlier panel, to a degree, is this whole political implication of the United States having supplied Iraq with so much in the way of dual-use technology during the 1980s that ultimately came back in the form of weapons that may have been used against us.
If your thesis is correct, are you suggesting that in a sense American technology supplied the precursor, is the word, for the assault on American troops?
And other organisms. I learned just in the last 2 weeks, in fact, that the Centers for Disease Control did not provide the Senate Banking Committee with a complete list of all the potential pathogens that were supplied to Iraq during the 1980s. They revealed this to a researcher, Dr. Leonard Cole at Rutgers, in 1995. The CDC apparently sent 80-plus samples.
So you're suggesting that the third reason is it would be very embarrassing, in fact, to have it given Saddam Hussein all of the stuff to get it back in our troops.
That's correct.
Let me just change focus, if I might, and ask if you have any information that we might not be familiar with. In this area, as you know, there is a debate taking place about the potential health problems associated with low-grade exposure to chemical agents. The Pentagon has insisted for a period of time that if one does not get an acute reaction, an immediate reaction, then there's probably not going to be a problem. That's the theory that they have been operating under. There is other scientific evidence that suggests otherwise, that in fact, you may end up having a long-term illness without receiving immediate acute effects. Do you have any thoughts on that?
And I want to apologize for the chair for the use of that initial report from Sergeant Morrissey. I did not intend for that to take us off track here, but I have included this specific document because it speaks directly to the issue that Representative Sanders is talking about. This particular document, which every unit or every member of Morrissey's unit was forced to sign in 1990, was classified secret, and it deals with this entire issue of the potential effects of being exposed to nerve agents, both acutely and at low levels. And let me just read once again this paragraph number 4. Signs and symptoms of chronic low-dose exposure, memory loss, decreased alertness, decreased problem-solving ability, and language problems are suspected but have not been proven in scientific study. The only proven effect of long-term exposure is EEG or brainwave changes without clinical significance. The purpose or the point of this is to show that the Department of Defense suspected that low-level exposure could cause these very kinds of problems, to include birth defects, which is covered in paragraph 5 here. So they knew.
What was the date that we're talking about when this statement, this information?
Mr. Morrissey signed this statement on January 19th, 1990. A full year before Desert Storm.
So your point would be that if somebody from the DOD said, our belief is that low-level exposure does not cause a problem, you're suggesting that
they lied.
Before the war, they had evidence to indicate the opposite.
In my opinion, they lied. Why? You know, I spent 11 years in the Army Reserve and National Guard. I have never seen a document like this. You classify something like this, and you classify medical records secret when clearly you're telling people that they could suffer long-term effects, serious long-term effects from chronic low-level exposures. The notion that the Department of Defense did not know is a fraud. It's a complete fraud, and this document makes it very clear that they understood the risk that these people were facing.
I'm sorry to ask you to repeat. The date on this document is before the war?
Is 1-1990, which would translate to January 19th, 1990, which is a full year before.
And what you're referring to is point number 4, signs and symptoms of chronic low-dose exposure?
That is correct, and also paragraph 5, which deals with the issue of birth defects, possible birth defect problems as a result of exposure to organophosphate compounds.
And you're suggesting, therefore, that this document directly contradicts the Pentagon's position.
Absolutely.
That they believe that low-level exposure might cause a problem.
Absolutely.
All right. Thanks very much, Mr. Chair.
We wrote, Mr. Deutsch, in July 2nd, 1996, in regards to Gulf War illnesses, and we got back a response on page 3. He said, we agree that the question of exposure is particularly important, this is chemical exposure,
For this reason, amidst growing concern and debate over whether U.S. troops have been exposed to chemical weapons or biological weapon agents, in March 1995, the acting DCI Admiral Studman directed the CIA performing a comprehensive review of all relevant intelligence information. Our study concluded no chemical weapon or biological agents were used by the Iraqis, and facilities now known to contain biological weapon agents were not bombed. Under what basis could he have made that statement? What data would he have had, would the director of the CIA have had to have made such a sweeping statement, in your judgment?
He would have had no basis whatsoever to make that statement on the basis of the information that I had in my possession and on the basis of the information that has subsequently been declassified up to this point and provided to the public.
What would he have pointed to? I mean, if he were in the room now, what would he have said was the basis for it, in your judgment?
I really can't speak to that, Mr. Chairman. I mean, to me, this is a very, very obvious problem, a very obvious circumstance. The intelligence information and the information coming from the people in the theater that we heard just earlier today was quite clear. The munitions were present. They were forward deployed to the lowest unit level. They were in Kuwait as well as Iraq. Contrary to what the CIA maintains to this day, these chemical weapons were in Kuwait. The evidence is overwhelming that they were in Kuwait. So I have no idea what would cause Dr. Deutsch to make that kind of a sweeping statement.
Well, see, that's one of the points that we wanted to establish in testimony. My only reason for wanting you to address this issue first was that the DOD and the CIA have made it very clear there was no offensive use of weapons. Mr. Deutsch was actually on a major TV network saying there was no known offensive use of chemical weapons at the very time that we had known that there was defensive exposure by our blowing up Kamisiyah, just as a fact, as one. When we got the CIA employee to spokesperson to come to our third hearing, I believe, she had made the comment that they had not interviewed one American soldier, it basically, I was led to believe that these statements of no offensive use, that no offensive use is known, or what took place when they said no defensive, and we know that's blatantly false. So they don't have much credibility with us. You obviously have left for a variety of reasons from the CIA, and I gather your basic testimony is that they didn't, let me put it this way, is that your testimony that the CIA really did not, to the best of your knowledge, conduct any thorough research on offensive or defensive potential exposure, and that you felt that their failure to do it caused you to want to step into this void, and that in the process of your stepping into this void, you found that they weren't listening to you, and so you ended up deciding to leave.
That is essentially accurate. We had a couple of things that were operating here. At the analytical level, we were basically telling people who had put their names on analyses that they were wrong, that these events occurred, and that moreover, they had been lied to by the Department of Defense.
Right.
So we weren't winning any friends and influencing any people by doing that. At the managerial level, I know from conversations that I had with managers who were close to me that they were terrified at the managerial level of having to try to deal with this. They did not want to have to confront the Department of Defense. And it was easy for me to understand why. General Schwarzkopf came out in June of 1991 and testified before Congress that the CIA did nothing for him during the Persian Gulf War. The CIA came in for tremendous criticism. So for the last 5.5 years, the CIA has spent a tremendous amount of time and money trying to ingratiate itself with the Department of Defense and make itself indispensable to DOD. Thousands of military visitors pass through the CIA every year. An entire office has been set up, a huge office, to coordinate support to the military. So here my wife and I walk in and tell them that their biggest customer is a liar and that tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of American troops have been exposed. Is that a message that's going to be well received by a conservative bureaucracy like the CIA? No, it's not.
Very interesting.
Mr. Eddington, help me out again here. The document that we were looking at,
where we talked about the impact of low-level exposure. And that was signed by the gentleman who acknowledged reading it, Mr. Morrissey.
That is correct.
And it also has the is the author of the document as a Richard W. Cramp, M.D. And then there's another name, Major, which is blackened out. Help me out here in understanding to whom this document was given. How many documents were given out? Was this, who received this?
You're talking about a unit with approximately 500 personnel in it, and every member of this unit was not only forced to sign this document, but their medical records were also classified secret. And Dr. Cramp, who apparently was the attending physician who signed this particular statement with Sergeant Morrissey, would have been involved in monitoring these personnel for any kind of signs and symptoms of exposure to chemical agents.
So to the best of your knowledge, there were 500 people who were asked to sign.
That was Sergeant Morrissey's comment to me in Seattle about 3 weeks ago, yes.
Now, I'd like to just end with that document and just have you spend 5 minutes going through it again, and I'll try to pay closer attention. What you started out with, you can start all over again.
I could be much briefer than that. This document, to my mind, clearly indicates that the department...
I want you to identify the document.
The document itself is entitled General Information, Nerve Agent Intoxication and Treatment. And according to Sergeant Morrissey, every member of his unit was forced to sign this particular document in 1989-1990 period. And this document clearly indicates, to my mind, that the Department of Defense knew that low-level exposure to these particular agents was a potential health risk.
If I might again, what was unique about this particular unit that they were asked to sign?
This document
was
passed out to personnel of the 330th Ordnance Company, which was assigned to the 59th Ordnance Brigade in Germany. Now, that brigade had the responsibility for guarding over 170,000 chemical nerve agent munitions.
Okay, thank you.
American chemical nerve agent munitions.
Okay, thank you. Sorry, continue, please.
That's fine. The document, and again, I've never seen anything like this. In the 11 years that I spent in the military, I never saw a document like this, a document that clearly tells the person who is signing it that you may experience long-term, perhaps lifelong, problems as a result of being in close proximity to these agents. It goes against everything the Department of Defense has claimed for the last 5 years, that they had no idea that low-level exposures would be a potential problem. That was the significance of the document. It is the significance of the document, and that's why I wanted to bring it to the committee's attention, because this clearly has implications as they apply to the vets, the Gulf War vets.
I think it has tremendous implications, and I appreciate you bringing before the committee. I guess for me it's a no-brainer that, and this is where my civilian world has more meaning to me than really what we're doing in terms of this investigation. In other words, I spent 13 years as a state representative dealing with chemical exposure in an environmental way, and we passed state laws that required people to be very careful how they handled certain chemicals, because even the smallest dosage we felt over time would cause serious health problems and maybe even result in death. So the civilian world was way over here, and it strikes me that I pretty much discounted the excuses of the military when they said that there's no threat from low-level exposure to chemicals. I mean, why in the real world of daily living do we monitor and fine and sue and do a whole host of things to individuals who handle or mishandle chemicals, and yet we act like there wouldn't be a problem to the military for their exposure to similar chemicals? So for me, they're just I don't feel I need a lot of military studies to have documented what we already know in the real world of public life, in civilian life. The fact that they actually had potential studies done when they denied it obviously calls questions their own ethics and their own credibility. Frankly, the VA, the DOD, and the CIA have very little credibility as it relates to any issue dealing with the Gulf War illnesses. That's why I will say to you that we are determined that this committee have all three parties participate in this effort, because ultimately they're going to be the solution. Now, having said that, giving the plea of the father of Mr. Hebert, that ultimately he just wants his son and other sons like his son treated and cared for. I mean, the overall need is to deal with proper diagnosis, treatment, and fair compensation. And I have said to the DOD and the CIA, I am far less concerned about placing blame, because I feel if they think that's my biggest concern, which it isn't, then they're not going to be coming as eagerly and as willingly with information I think they have that could move us along a lot more quickly. And so my message is to the CIA and to the DOD, I care less about focusing responsibility, who's to blame, and I think Congress does focus less concern on that, and ultimately just give us the information that can help us heal our soldiers. Your testimony has been helpful to this committee, and I think that you have a lot of information that it's probably even difficult for you to decide what to disseminate, but we need little pieces, and ultimately we'll get to the whole. Do you have any last comment you want to make?
Chairman, I like the way that you ended the last panel. I had not heard of that before, and let me ask Mr. Eddington that. Are there questions that we have not asked you that you wish we had, that you would like to ask yourself and then give us that answer?
Mr. Sanders, I believe that one question that should be asked, not just by this committee, but by several committees, is why is it that John Deutsch and Norris Slatkin attempted to prevent the release and attempted, in fact, to reclassify several hundred documents that had to do with this very issue? Why did they do that? What was their motivation for removing over 300 documents from the internet that had been properly declassified by competent authority, the Department of Defense? A decision that forced me to file suit in order to get those documents declassified. Why? What was so damaging about those documents? Well, what was damaging about the documents was that they totally invalidated the DOD-CIA position that there were no chemical munitions deployed in Kuwait and southeastern Iraq, further southwest or southeast of Qamishia. So that's an issue that I really feel needs to be raised vigorously.
Let me just maybe ask you a final question. Obviously, the main concern that all of us have is that doing the best that we can for the men and women who are affected by the various illnesses associated with the Persian Gulf Syndrome. Do you have any information, any thoughts as to whether or not the VA and the, our hospitals and our doctors are doing as good as they might?
It's very difficult for them to do as good as they might, given the fact that they don't have complete data.
The lack of this information makes it very difficult for them to do their job, is what you're saying.
Particularly as it pertains to this potential biological exposure issue. As I think our previous witnesses testified, the United States had no effective biological agent detection capability in the Gulf. And we know that Iraq had in its inventory and had weaponized things such as anthrax, botulinum toxoid, aflatoxin has been mentioned. The Iraqis may have been working on other forms of mycotoxins that have not been previously disclosed or discussed in any great detail.
Are you suggesting that some of those biological agents may have been used?
I believe that that did happen at the Saudi port of Jubail, yes. I do believe it did, because if you look at the specific descriptions that the Seabees who were stationed there give in the Senate Banking Committee investigation's May 25th report, the signs and symptoms that they report are largely consistent with exposure to trichothecene mycotoxins, T2 mycotoxins, more commonly known in the press as yellow rain. There may also have been a chemical agent involved in that as well, a mixed agent attack, if you will, since we know that some of the CBs got positive M256 kit test for chemical blister agent. But the overall symptomologies being described by those CBs, in my opinion, are consistent with exposure to some kind of mycotoxin.
Ms. Dennington, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Dennington, it's just another area that I just need a fairly quick response. To the best of your knowledge, do we have any way of determining exposure to biological agents? And do you have any information about biological agents potentially being used or being used?
In the discussion that I had with Mr. Sanders just a moment ago, I made note of the fact that it's my opinion that a form of mycotoxin was probably employed against the Saudi port of Jubail on the 19th of January, 1991. As far as the protocols for testing, that is somewhat outside the range of my medical knowledge. That would be a question for a toxicologist.
Thank you. Well, you were giving the answer. I was asking that question.
Understood.
Bottom line, we have tried to deal with three no's that DOD and VA and others have been espousing, that there's no credible detections, no exposures, and therefore no provable health consequences. And we do think there are credible detections, and we do think that the exposures are real. And our hearing tomorrow is going to be how the VA is responding to these credible detections and credible exposures, how they are changing their protocol, and how they are now going to respond in a more effective way to the DOD. I mean, that will be part of what we cover tomorrow. I appreciate your testimony before this committee, and before we adjourn, I'd like to thank our two court reporters, Leanne Dotson and Bill Odom, and Amy Davenport from the full committee, and Bob Newman and Tom Costa and Cheryl Phelps for their work as well. And this is the process that we are going to continue, and we're just going to keep applying more and more pressure until we get the right answers. Thank you very much. And with that, the hearing is adjourned. 3 days? Do I have a 3 day? Yeah, 3 day.
This subcommittee will continue hearing from military personnel today and on January 21st. The exact makeup of the 105th Congress will become more clear soon, as the state of Texas held runoff elections for three House seats yesterday. This follows a Supreme Court ruling earlier this year, which led to congressional redistricting in 13 Texas districts.